Good morning, everybody. It's Tuesday. It's Collider Live. 2 days before we get really fat on turkey and stuff.
Yeah.
What a day we have today. I am beyond excited because yesterday I wasn't sure if we were going to be able to announce this or not because I wasn't sure we confirmed it. We're going to have Steven Caple Jr., the director of Creed 2, in the studio today.
Great movie. Awesome movie.
We'll talk about that in a
Fantastic
second. Don't worry about it.
I heard him screaming in the office.
It was privilege, wasn't it? We'll talk about it in a second. welcome back to the show. Roxy Striar, how are you?
I'm doing great,
it's
Kristian.
Nice to see
how
you.
Are you? Good to see you always.
Brett Sheridan, nice to see you.
Hello.
Boo.
Yeah,
Oh, my God.
Mark Reilly, how are you?
Boo.
Yeah. And someone who I think had just as much of a fit as my six-year-old did this morning, Josh Macuga.
Yeah, what's up?
You had a nice fit this morning.
I did.
Screaming in the office like a three-year-old.
I'm yelling.
Yes, ridiculous.
I've asked you one thing in probably...
Yeah, a couple times. You asked me a couple screenings. But this was this
what,
is
what other screenings did I ask you to?
I don't remember much. Okay. I'm not going to remember the screening.
But there was one that I passionately asked you about multiple times.
You asked me for Creed 2.
Listen, I don't need Avengers 4. I'll eventually see it. I get it. Thanos is going to come. We're
Creed 2
beat
is
Thanos,
your Avengers.
Whatever. Creed 2 was what I wanted to see.
And I understand that. I said I would take you.
Yes.
Then what happened was we heard we were going to potentially get the director of the show on.
Uh-huh.
So Frosty reached out to me and said, okay, the publicist wants you to see the movie first before you interview. And so we locked him down. He's supposed to originally come in yesterday.
Okay.
So at the same time, the all media, which is the press screening, was last night as well.
Sure.
I was not invited to that one.
Okay.
So the first one, that's on Frosty, so you can yell at him. The second one, no, I wasn't invited to. So how is that my fault? I couldn't take you last night. I was at Monday Night
Raw.
But
you knew that there was a press screening.
Yeah,
here
but I didn't
comes.
Go.
But you could have.
She knew too. Everybody knew.
I didn't ask Roxy.
I know, but no, everybody knew.
But you guys are besties.
See, I don't... I don't.
Which
get
of us? Macuga
and Macuga.
I do love Macuga. Yeah. I thought about bringing Macuga. Can I tell you what happened?
Sure.
Here's what happened. I honestly was like gonna make his week, and I was so excited about it. I needed to use it as a bargaining chip because I had to get here this morning because I have to Uber to the airport, and I didn't want to Uber here,
so
Uber
wanted,
to the airport.
I see.
And
so who'd you take?
I took Sarah Stratton because she said she would. If
good.
I
she
took her,
it's
good choice.
Industry.
Great choice. Great choice.
Good call.
She said
good call.
If I took her.
She doesn't host the live show that's going to have the director. Yeah, totally. You could have asked me. I would have gone down to your apartment.
You would
picked
know,
you up.
No.
I would have. I would have. For Creed 2, I would have.
She you know who lives
me
right
first.
By the airport?
She slept over last night. She cuddled with me all night, and then she drove me here this morning.
I can't
morning.
Do that. I'm married, so I can't do that. But I would gladly. I would have gladly driven to your apartment, picked you up for the Creed 2.
I think you would have.
I would have.
I didn't want to be like Josh.
All the way down,
what am I supposed to say?
Driven back out.
Josh, will you come with me to Creed 2? By the way, here are all of the rules that come with it.
Sure.
All right, so we figured out
it
here
sounds
that
like it would have.
Roxy was in the wrong.
Yes.
She could, it's just not my fault.
Yeah.
All right, now we move on. But speaking
but
of
it, could
I,
have
I
been
talk
your,
a little more about that?
Hold on.
What?
It could have been your fault because Frosty reached out. There are multiple media. Here's the thing.
What?
All you cool kids get your emails about screeners, right? Like
yes.
Snyder's over there. He's like, I got an advanced screening to a movie that hasn't been released.
I know. Can I tell you where I'm in the wrong?
Sure.
I'm going to admit defeat here.
Yeah.
I had a plus one and I forgot.
Yeah. Cool.
I didn't take anybody.
Cool.
I didn't take anybody. I went there and I said, and they said, I honestly didn't think I had one because they said, did you bring your plus one? And all I thought was Sad Macuga. And I was like, you know what? I'm not even going to. Bring it up.
Yeah.
But then when you yelled at me this morning, I said, might as well bring it up on the air.
So I can't wait. Yeah. I can't wait until the new Star Wars game comes out for EA and I get a personal invite to Mark Hamill's living room to play Xbox.
Yeah.
And
why
I'm
going to
bring happening? I'm going to bring Mark Reilly and Mark Ellis.
There we are.
Well, but wait, you know, the other, you know why? You know
you're
why,
not getting invited.
Do you know why I did
sure.
this? This is because I hold grudges.
Sure.
And
I'm going to hold this grudge.
Good, because then we're even. Six good. Years ago,
sure.
You had a pasta
really?
At your house.
I did.
Mark Ellis was there.
Uh-huh.
Justine Marino was there.
Yeah.
Never got a call.
Yeah, it's true.
Yeah. Wow. So there we go. So we're even.
Okay.
Kristian had a birthday party this year, and I wasn't invited to that.
All right, so you hold a grudge too.
Yeah, but that was no pasta night.
It wasn't.
But did I make up for it and come over to your house and make pasta carbonara along with your wife?
Yeah, but it was kind of mixed.
Can I ask why was Kristian not invited to pasta night?
I forgot.
Yeah. Oh, good.
Right. So we're even.
There you go.
He forgot.
But would you have come? But would you have come
back then? Yeah, I didn't have kids. I had an 8-month-old.
Yeah.
So
no.
Probably not. But I would have. But I would have liked the invite.
Yep.
Yeah. Yep. Because it smelled good from the pictures.
Yeah.
That's
but what
how
did
that
you?
Works.
What did you think of the? What did you think of the movie?
Holy crap. I don't want to talk about it because you want to wait here. Oh. Well, no, I just feel
Brett's going to take my place for the day.
Well, listen, I'm going home. Well, you get a chance to talk to the director.
Yeah, and okay. About what? Rocky IV?
Let me tell you.
I love Rocky. This was supposed to be an exhibition.
Uh-oh, that's good. Oh.
I did not see that coming.
I did not see that coming.
It's a full body.
Yeah, confusion.
It's like this physics.
Here's what I'll tell you, though. Here's why you're in a really good position. Because now you and Kristian are even. You and I are not even.
Yeah.
So now I owe you one, and that's a good place to be.
Okay.
So.
There you go.
Ask.
You owe me like six.
I owe you six.
I think so. Huh. I mean, if we went back in time, I'm sure we could find six.
All right.
I don't know.
I'll pay up six.
Okay.
That seems like a fair number.
I feel like I didn't invite you to pasta night because you were still upset about the Valentine's Day.
It wasn't. You keep saying Valentine's Day. It wasn't the Valentine's Day.
Oh, it wasn't Valentine's Day.
And it was. And that was afterwards.
Okay.
Yeah. So that doubled up on the reason I was angry because I was still holding resentment for the pasta night.
Okay.
That pasta. I remember what it looked like in the pictures. It was
pretty good.
And it was delicious.
Who made the food?
He does.
I make.
He can cook.
You know who else wasn't invited to pasta night?
You weren't a blip on the radar yet. No one knew who you were.
Nobody knew who you were.
This is way before you.
This is where we were still in an office in Hollywood at the WeWork space.
I still wasn't invited.
Yeah, well, no one knew who you were.
I mean, I think we were still in college.
We also didn't invite Mary Simpson.
Yeah.
She wasn't invited. Yeah.
No. Nope.
Yeah. You know who we didn't also
Mary
invite?
Mary Simpson. Yeah. Huge following on Twitter.
Giant.
We should get her on the show.
You know who else we didn't invite? Cool. Sarah Stratton. We didn't invite her, but you know where she got invited? To a movie she's probably never seen any of the other Rockies.
No, she's a huge Rocky fan.
Okay, I'm bringing Sarah Stratton. You know what? Somebody, you've got her number over there.
Cops
text her. Have her call her in the studio. I want to talk to Sarah Stratton right now.
She's on my shit list.
Sarah's.
Yeah.
Because of Schmodown stuff? Yeah. She knows.
She ran up to me at the Schmodown Awards, told me how much she wants to play in her geekdom. She's like, I want to play this season. I have to play. And I said, I'll get you a match. Five times I tried to get her a match, put her in the tournament.
She's busy.
And she's like, oh, no, it wasn't busy. So she said, I don't want to play a certain competitor because she didn't have the knowledge ready yet.
You know where she got that from?
Where?
Me. I told her, do not play that person. They will literally wipe the
Now you owe Kristian seven.
Oh, man. I owe me seven. Yeah, it's true.
She was like, yeah.
Do you think she was supposed to play Rachel Cushing.
Yeah. And Rachel would have taken her and ragdolled her.
That's because of most people. Rachel
Text
can be.
Stratton right now. She's available. We want her to Skype in or call in.
I know for a fact she's at work.
Oh, what's work? Can she call
can
from
she
work?
Step out?
No. She does the whole Finstock production stuff.
Yeah, but he shows up here in a truck that he stole.
Yeah, but so she doesn't drive the truck. She actually works.
I got to tell you, I love when he shows up in that truck. It's so ridiculous.
Yeah, it's
so
absurd. Yeah.
It's
Do you know we went to dinner, sushi, movie, and he's driving that truck?
I mean, when I paint the picture to you guys out there, the truck is the Beverly Hills Cop truck.
It's like, where are you going to park?
But he's not supposed to do that.
No, of course not. But can Sarah Stratton talk for like 3 minutes on the phone from work? Text her right now. See if in the next 2 hours.
I take my orders from Kristian.
If she's able to, absolutely.
There you go.
All right.
Yeah,
we can give her the Skype. Hey boys, are we set up to somebody?
What
can Skype
I like that watch. On Rocky
or whatever. I'm gonna ask her serious Rocky questions.
Yeah. That's so stupid.
No, don't. Yes, it is. I don't want to quiz her on Rocky.
I'm not gonna quiz her. I'm just gonna ask her passion in Rocky. If she had the Rocky IV soundtrack. If she thinks Rocky IV
okay,
ended communism.
I can tell you the answer is no. Yeah. And
she likes
maybe.
The movies though. But she likes the movies.
She likes the movies.
And she probably really likes.
A different
she time. Probably loves Creed, right? The first one.
She loved Creed. She liked this one equally.
Okay.
As I did.
I think fans she are going to love
freaking,
this movie.
What was so insane about the screening, was that people treated it.
What, did you not go? Sorry.
Why didn't he show up?
Thank you, Alex.
People treated it as if it was a
great
sports
time
event.
Alex.
Like, I don't know if that happened in your audience,
no,
but for us, everybody and their mothers were screaming.
See, I wish I would have went to that screening.
Yeah.
I wish I would have went to
screaming, cheering. It was a fan screening, though. It was half media,
That's
half
great.
Fan.
I was happy to go and see it, but the problem was I saw it at the MGM screening room, right? Which is a beautiful screening room. Great sound.
The best.
There were 13.
No better place to see a film.
There were 13 people. In the screening room,
could have
right?
been 14,
maybe. And
thanks, Brett.
And inside of that, if you agree with this, the sound wasn't really good.
Oh God,
it was really
the nice. Best THX.
Yeah, I thought so. And the guy sitting next to us was nice enough. You didn't go, but you know who he was.
You
know what I'm talking about.
He didn't
about.
Take two cup holders like some jackass.
Afterthoughts kids agreed with me.
Afterthoughts kids did agree. But anyway, it didn't. I wanted that environment you had, so I probably go. How
it
about
was
this?
Unreal.
How about I make you a deal? How about I make you a deal? It's not the best deal, but it's a deal. Burbank 16, I will buy you a ticket and a beer, and we'll go see it together.
Okay.
Deal?
Is this like the Star is Born
no,
deal?
No, this one we'll do for real.
Okay.
I'll buy you a beer, and I'll buy you a ticket. sooner than later when it comes. I mean, it comes out this weekend, right?
Yeah, so but what are you going
to? Are you going to see it with your wife? This
she
weekend?
Don't want to see this.
All right, so then let's after the break.
Yeah,
you come back if you can hold off.
You're going to not see it until after the break.
He's going to be doing something.
Yeah,
with
his
family.
I'm up in Tahoe with my family. Yeah.
So we'll see it. I promise you that we'll see it next week.
Okay.
I will take you. I will take
can
you
I
next
come?
Week if you like. Absolutely, 100%. So, but I'm not buying your ticket. I'm only buying yours.
You win some, you lose some.
Yeah. Otherwise, you owe me.
I'll buy your ticket.
Because you owe me.
And I'll buy your ticket. I'm taking you guys.
No. You're not pulling this into his. He owes me.
No,
you still owe me.
I owe him. So I'll do that. I'll because Burbank sells the beers. I'll get you a beer.
Okay.
And we'll do that. And then we'll, you know, we'll send out. Well, then you're going to owe me pasta.
Sure.
Let's see. Yeah.
I'm glad you should cook pasta because that's good for me.
I think Roxy should have the pasta.
I agree with that.
And not invite anyone.
I make a great bolognese.
Yeah, Brett's a good cook too.
Yeah, I bet.
Yeah, cook it up.
He's got kids.
Well, Alex usually gets the for the schmodown. He takes care of everybody.
Did you see what he brought in yesterday? Nobody ate any of them.
Wait, I'm so confused.
Delicious.
But why are they still sitting out?
Yeah, yeah.
They probably should have been refrigerated.
I don't know. Yeah.
I wanted to eat one, but now I'm like, I'm gonna get real sick.
Lumpia is always good if it's like 2 or 3 days.
Oh, okay.
If it's out, it's fine. We Filipinos know how to do it.
See,
nice.
I trust Alex. I trust Alex.
I do not. Yeah. I do not.
I do not.
Are you
not.
Kidding me?
Yeah, that's a soundbite.
That's meat.
Speaking of sound bites, I listen. There's a brand new. There's a brand new song that hit the airwaves.
Who did
on
it?
The way over.
Ooh, the airwaves.
Yeah, it was
classic.
Well, because Brett.
They're called airwaves too.
Thank you. Brett and I were driving over today. Brett and Brett's car. Brett gave me a ride this morning because I went to Monday Night Raw. I Ubered over. I left the car here, and.
Well, that's
driving,
why.
That's why what?
That's why you asked me for a ride.
Yeah.
I was asked first, and I also couldn't do it.
Right.
So
you know what you didn't ask me for?
A ride. Yeah. Oh, continue.
Chris. You wouldn't have come. He's on the way. I should have asked him first before I asked you.
I'm 3 minutes from the airport, by the way. You could park in front of my apartment. And
Are you going home after this?
Yeah. At 11. Though.
Look at now.
I usually park in
Playa
Vista.
Do you want to wait until 12 and drive me to your home and then I'll Uber to the airport?
That's the life hack is you park near Playa Vista or in El Segundo and then just Uber to the airport.
But we were listening to radio on the way over, and I haven't listened to the radio, and I heard a great song, and I asked Cobbster and Cody if they had heard this song as well. They knew it. Mm. At first you thought it was, who'd you think it was?
Calvin Harris.
You thought it was Calvin Harris. It was not Calvin Harris. Guys, Cody, do you happen to have that
David
song?
David Guetta?
Yeah, we've got it.
Here we go. Here it is.
Oh, there it is.
Oh, okay.
Shh, quiet, everyone.
Boom! 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 Horseman! Fuck you, Frank. Fuck you, Frank. Fuck you, Frank. Fuck you, Frank. Horseman!
Sorry.
Leroy!
That one got me.
It's good, beautiful guys. Sorry,
the dong take.
That was really good. It was called the dong take.
We didn't hear Roxy's in there.
Oh yeah, can we hear Roxy's part of the song?
Aliens and shit. Aliens and shit. Aliens and shit. Mm. Unless it doesn't fucking matter because aliens and shit.
That's one.
For him.
All right, that was beautiful, guys. Thank
one
you.
Cobbster, one.
You guys are right. It's like your DJ Kaoki, or whatever his name is.
Album drops next Tuesday.
Steve Aoki?
Yeah, whatever. Okay.
You're dead mile five.
The other thing I want to, because we mentioned, you heard Dong Take in there. You can, it's like we said, the Afterthoughts guys coined that phrase. They are doing a Q&A this Friday. The Afterthoughts guys are doing a Q&A.
Listen, how and where?
Well, they're doing it this Friday. And if you want to get some of the questions in there, tweet at WhatUpSnell. With the hashtag Collider Afterthoughts, and they're going to do a Q&A, both him and Jay, for the show. So Afterthoughts Q&A this Friday, tweet at WhatUpSnell with the hashtag Collider Afterthoughts, and get some questions in there. And for those of you who want to listen to the show, it's on the Collider Live podcast feed. The other thing that I got confirmation on yesterday is that we are officially going to be moving to Spotify.
Wow. Wow.
Nice.
Like we, as in you individually, are going to be listening
the entire network. The entire network.
Now you have to figure it out.
I know. The entire network will be doing we're not moving off of Apple or the other.
Just saying though, we're not on Pandora.
We're not on Pandora, but we are moving to
Spotify. Don't say
Spotify
that to Spotify people.
Well.
Don't even bring up that word Spotify.
It's beef.
No, listen. I have a friend that works at Spotify. Yeah. I turn on Pandora. He's like, "What are you doing?" Right. He's like, "Oh, my bad."
That sounds like Jay Williams. Yeah. Because the whole thing was, I still listen to Pandora because with the kids, it's easy to put it at Elmo Radio, and that's the end of it. but I had this whole thing. The Afterthoughts guys, the whole weekend we're talking about how got to get into Spotify. So now we're doing Spotify for the podcast, and it should happen. I don't know when it's going to happen. I just got the confirmation yesterday.
Mm.
Yeah.
What was the conversation like between Jay, Ryan, and yourself that got you to say only Ryan's social media handle on air?
This morning, he's the one who produces their show, so he's the one that's able to if he asked for them to tweet it out at him and. Hashtag it.
It's easy to condense it.
Why do you think it's a little rude not to include Jay?
Yeah, a little rude.
No, it condenses the thing. We don't need. He's like, oh, I saw this one. It's all in Snell. He can do it. Putting all those Twitter handles muddies the waters.
You just think they should be on equal playing.
I do.
Yeah, because you also like Jay.
I do.
Yeah. See, that's.
I want my first question to be, what do you think of Macuga? That's what I think. Yeah, honest opinion.
Listen
opinions.
To their show.
No.
They actually didn't like you again this week.
Oh, good.
No, they did not like you, but they in the Macuga Brett. Battle, they are Team Brett.
Oh, yeah, cool. Yeah, I don't give a fuck.
That's one.
Well, they times, do like you. They well do used, like
you.
I would say.
I think, I don't know. They said you had a dong take this week. I can't remember what it was.
They do really like you.
They do like you a lot.
They do like you.
Yeah.
You don't they
wanna,
do like
but
you
But you don't
want
to hear about it.
You don't want to hear about it.
They like you a lot, man.
They like you.
They like you, man. They really like you.
I like those guys.
They really like you.
Sounds like it.
You know who I like? I like those guys way more than you do, jackasses.
That's true. I understand.
I get it.
Do I love you both? Of course. Right, right now, I'm bad. Not a big fan of yours.
I do feel bad.
Thank you.
Do you really?
Yeah, but I didn't want to ask him for the ride.
Well, yeah, but it was if you knew how much he loves Creed.
Yeah, but it felt like trading instead of giving.
Is it because
something.
I make you watch that Mexican hammer firework video?
Might be.
It's not because of that.
Okay.
Right.
Just saying.
Do you love that? By the way. This is something that I'm not going to show because it's horrible and where this isn't even funny. I went to Monday Night Raw, and I know I talked yesterday, and there were a lot of responses to the Ronda Rousey thing, and thank you for everybody who commented on it. She got a much better reception last night when I went to the Staples Center to watch the actual show. It was a fun show. It was good. But Satin posted yesterday on Pro Wrestling Sheet, or it may have been this morning. There was this wrestling match in Mexico, right? So the guys
I've been watching a lot of Narcos Mexico. That country scares the living crap out of me.
But listen to this. I saw the footage of this.
Based on that show.
So these two guys are fighting. It's a scripted match, as we know. Guy walks out. He's got something in his hand. We don't know what it is. And they were doing the match already. So he comes in. He puts something down in the ring. Then the other guy... is outside the ring, and he hits the one guy in the head with the chair. And then he hits him in the head with the chair again. It pisses off the guy. So the guy picks up this thing, picks it up, and throws it and hits the guy in the head with it. It's a fucking, I'll use it,
one.
Cinder block.
Oh, God.
A legit cinder block.
And it hits him.
It hits him in the head. The blood goes everywhere.
Jesus.
He knocks the guy out cold. They show, and the announcers are screaming like it's part of the thing. And the guy, he gets up, and he goes, and he's in the hospital, but... arrest that person.
He gets up.
Yeah, he got up and he walked in the back. He had to go to the hospital and he had,
you have to arrest that person.
Arrest that person. That is attempted murder.
Yeah.
That is attempted murder.
That's messed up.
And it's like,
does it work differently there? Like,
I don't know. I don't know. I mean, I think so. I just saw it this morning. Like, again,
this
pro
is why I don't
had,
watch wrestling.
This, no, this
did
is
did we know
dude,
he
this
had
is,
that?
This, this always not, happens. Macuga's right.
This is anything that would ever happen in the WWE. Especially after watching that show last night and watching what the production of it and just in general, compared to what this was a crime. This is a crime. This is an absolute crime. So anyway, the story's over at ProWrestlingSheet.com if you want to check out what I'm talking about, too. It was it's insane. I think that Sat and I were both on the same page. This person needs to be jailed. Crazy.
That's
what if the other person knew?
There's no way he knew. He was looking up to the side, and it just you don't say, because the other thing is, too, the other thing is David Arquette, who was just in here.
Yeah.
like, what was it, five days
last
ago.
Last Thursday.
Promoting this.
Where was I?
I don't know.
He was came later in the day.
Yeah, so he did this. It's called a death match, whatever that he was doing, right? It was. So Ryan Satin has been to so much over the last week. There was the death match that he had, that Arquette had on Thursday. Friday, excuse me. And then Saturday was NXT. Sunday was the Survivor Series. Tonight was Monday Night Raw. And then
last night.
And then tonight is SmackDown. So a lot going on in LA. But the deathmatch thing, this is not WWE. This is something completely different. It was at like this school or something. And David Arquette was fighting this dude, comes back to wrestling, because David Arquette back in like the late 90s, you know, Ready to
Rumble,
won the WCW championship.
Great movie. Yeah, right.
So he's fighting this guy. And what are those the stupid things in the lights? What are the big... the
chandeliers?
Not the chandeliers. The big... the lights. The actual lights themselves in the glass.
Halogens.
Yes.
The things.
Guy's got a halogen, smashes it over Arquette's head, right? Then he's cutting him with it on his head. But he's as he's grinding into Arquette's head, Arquette... like gets a little nervous and moves, and then he cuts over here, and then he's holding his neck. He runs out to the back. This is why WWE does not do blood anymore. Right. They don't do this kind of stuff.
Yeah.
And they run out. He runs out, but he comes back to finish the match. But it went terribly wrong. Don't bring up the actual clip itself, guys, but just bring up like David Arquette, and it'd probably be one of the first things that comes up. It was crazy.
Let me just
this guy's like 55 years old.
Whatever. Yeah. Okay.
Why would you do this?
Yeah.
Here, look. Here you go. God. David Arquette issues statement of bloody incident at indie event. More from the incident. Yeah. Former WCW World Heavyweight Champion. That's so funny.
Good Lord.
But yeah, it's crazy.
So, you know, I follow you on Twitter. I follow Greg Miller from Kind of Funny. And you guys are both big wrestling guys. And Greg Miller was at this stuff all weekend.
Yeah, he was
at
Survivor Series.
Kathy Kelly announces for it, whatever. Yep. I see all kinds of things. I see like pictures of people with kendo sticks and chairs and all that stuff, and I've seen bloody stuff in the WWE.
Yeah, it happens sometimes. I mean, Becky Lynch got caught last week. She got caught with a right hand in the nose, broke her face, and bloody nose.
Okay, so you're saying that doesn't do blood anymore?
Well, no, but it's not that's intentional blood. Okay. That's intentional, like, you know, we're going for the effect to
like
cut
the
you
old
off
ECW.
And, yeah, 100%. Yeah. That's not what WWE does. Does blood happen? Yeah, it absolutely happens. But Vince kind of said no. They used to cut themselves with razors and do all that stuff, and that's a no-no.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, no.
He actually does not like when people bleed on air anymore.
I just.
Yeah.
And you pitched it to me yesterday as like, watch it like you're watching an action movie. I can't do that.
Yeah.
I can't.
I'm just saying, there's no way to sell you on it.
Because did you see that exchange on your Twitter yesterday or on your Instagram with that dude?
What was it?
There was some dude that was like, did you convince Josh Macuga to go? And I just wrote, no. And he's like, come on, da 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 da. And I was like, no, I value my time too much.
You said you would go to one. You told me that you would go and the actual event.
But I mean, I got to be sold on this. I got to be buttered up a little
bit. I wish, actually, the funny thing
really
is.
Really, the live one wouldn't be fun in itself.
Yeah.
I mean, watching it on
I'm
TV
just saying,
is
like,
dumb.
You give me
he
good would have seats, a few dumb. Beers, a parking
I should have taken you last night to this one, too.
Yeah.
Because I'll tell
now
you.
Now you owe him, too.
No, because this is not an owe him.
No, this is definitely not an owe him.
This is, I think that he would have. Because the thing is, Satin got me a ticket last night. But I got there early and he was running behind. So I'm outside the Staples Center. And I'm like, I don't want to, because the show is going to start at 5. And it's like,
5?
Because it's live on the East Coast. So I'm standing outside, and I'm like, he wasn't going to get there until around 5 now because of traffic and everything, too. I'm like, I want to see the beginning of the show. And they already started, like, the undercard matches. So I was like, I got to figure a way to get into the damn event without a ticket. Lo and behold, there's this radio thing right outside, and they're like, hey, we're giving away tickets. And I was like, well, what do I got to do? She's like, nothing. It just started. Here, take a ticket. I'm going to be winding up in the bleachers here. Right. It was, I don't know, 15, 20 rows on ringside. It was incredible. And then it just turns out that Satin seats were literally one over.
Oh, wow.
But anyway, like, just I had an extra ticket. Probably couldn't get 3 extra tickets. But how did I know that? I think last night would you have become a wrestling fan afterwards? No. But I think you'd enjoy the live aspect of it, and especially because you know what we go for in the Shimoda.
Right. I went to a live wrestling thing when I was 11 in Pittsburgh at the old Civic Arena. Jake the Snake Roberts. Gold Dust fought Shawn Michaels.
Oh, wow.
It was like, you know, yeah. And I walked out of there knowing I'd never do that again.
Yeah, it's not for everybody.
It's not for me.
I was talking to my wife about it last night because potentially I might be going to SmackDown tonight. And
she's psyched.
She's watching. We got Mission Impossible 5 last night. Nice. So she was watching it, and she
6.
6. Thank you.
Fallout.
Yes.
Mustache.
Thank you. And she's watching.
Best movie of the year.
Well. And did it come out this year?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Best movie
yeah.
of the year. Yeah.
Do you think 2018. It's in there.
It's good.
It's fucking a masterpiece. It's bonkers.
Wow.
Wow.
Do you love? Do you?
Wow.
I don't know if I'd call it a masterpiece.
I loved
but it's
it.
Really
so
good.
It's on another level. That director just needs to do Mission Impossible movies forever.
You liked it better than the fifth one.
Oh yeah.
Really?
Yeah. I mean, it might be my favorite one out of all.
Wow. Really?
Yeah. Yeah. I didn't like it better than the fifth.
All right. Continue.
Yeah.
Sorry.
I think I like the fifth one.
Yeah. I would go fifth one, fourth one, then this one, then 3, then 1, and then 2.
I think I might be Got right that? With yeah. you on that one.
Yeah. I like. I just. I didn't find this one as clever.
They
as
all
the other.
Just seem to fit right in, except for three two. Or
no,
two.
Two
is the
two.
Crap one.
Three yeah. was. Three. Again, three this is what J.J. Abrams does very well. He reboots franchises incredibly. He's yeah. done it 3 times.
Yep.
Star Trek, Mission Impossible, and Star Wars.
Right.
And he did it. He did it again with Mission Impossible, and it got everybody back on track. But yeah, anyway, she was watching that last night. We were talking this morning. And I told her the same thing. I was like, if you watch, and the same thing like Ellis, if you watch wrestling like a fake sport, you're not only going to dislike it, you're going to hate it. Because, mm-hmm. because some guy wrote to me yesterday, and he was like, why do they care if they win a championship? Why is that accolades? Like, why does that care? They scripted out that person was going to win. Why do they care? So, well, there's a lot of things. One, that performer got themselves to a level to where they're performing enough. The championship level still means that they're main event, that they are trusted enough by Vince and the crew that they are going to entertain people in that spot, because if you're not at a main event level, no matter what you are, people will walk, they won't care. And that's what the championships mean. So it's just, there was, you got to look at it more. I was telling you, like an action show or scripted television, you don't have to like every scripted television, but that's kind of how you should look at it more than, say, a fake sport, because it's not a fake sport. It's just it happens to be an action show with sketches and characters.
Okay.
Yeah. So right. that's really what it is. It's not trying to sell anybody. This is why you should like it. It's just a perspective.
Sure. Macuga, I think you and I could go to a wrestling thing. Beers would flow,
yes.
and we'd have a good time.
Yeah, I'm sure we'd yell stuff.
Yeah,
and
it would get.
I come?
I would. Sure. That is a bit to me that I would love to do.
Roxy, you just want to go everywhere.
Yeah, I do.
I love it.
I
love it so
everywhere.
Much.
I like everything.
Yeah.
Would you come to Mexico with us on 4th of July?
For sure.
You were going.
Would you use one of those hammers?
Sure.
Firework hammer.
We got the best fireworks too.
Yeah.
Yeah,
that was perfect.
That was good. Okay. That was good. All right, let's get into some news. Riley, what the hell's going on? Anything good happened yesterday at all?
It's pretty slow because of this Thanksgiving holiday.
Oh, yeah.
This is when I always say, like, once Thanksgiving comes around, we enter a dead zone.
Yeah.
Of news, but the Lego trailer dropped. That's big. A lot of people excited.
Okay. It was the second one, right?
Second. It's trailer? The second one. Yep.
When's that come out? February.
When does it come
because
out?
Because the first one came out like...
Yeah, I think that's right.
That's when they usually release those things. By the way, before you get into news, By the way, Ellis and I got into... we did a review of Wreck-It Ralph 2 yesterday, right?
Sure.
Which I enjoyed. And I didn't...
Me too.
I didn't realize that the first one was 6 years ago.
Whoa.
Crazy, right? 2012.
Holy moly.
Is that true?
I did not know that.
I didn't know that. I said the same thing. And Cobbster was in the booth, and I was like, no. I was like, maybe 2014.
Right.
Or 2013, whatever I said. I said, check, and it was 2012. Ellis is pretty good when it comes to those release dates anyways.
But for me, my mind works, and I'm sure other people think like this, but like if it's after 2005, I was like, oh, it's like 2 weeks ago.
Right.
Like mid-2000s, or like in 2000, I was listening to The Daily this morning. It was like in 2011, the Arab Spring. I was like, man, that was like 2 years ago. It's 2018.
Yeah.
Like, I keep forgetting how long ago things were.
Well, the pasta thing was like 6 years ago.
I know.
It was crazy.
Still bitter.
I remember when we did. Oh,
I thought we were past the pasta,
yeah.
guys.
No.
Come on.
Never going to let it go. I remember we did so there was this Chrismukkah party that my friends.
Oh, it was the best.
And they had them for years, and they were so good. I don't know if you went. You went to one of the last good ones.
I went
to St. Nick's.
The last one at St. Nick's.
Yeah.
And then the house party at
Bonnie's
house.
That was the last one. That was the best.
So was it Bonnie who used to throw them?
No. Bonnie. So my friends from school and people that I do out here threw them, and the whole apartment complex used to be packed with people. It was, I mean, as wild a party as you can imagine things happening, it happened at Chrismukkah,
yeah.
right? And it was amazing. And my friend Eric, who really went overboard, he would get the big, the one, I don't know if it was the year that you went, but these huge Christmas teddy bears that you could see from the street. I mean, it was crazy. He went all out. Everybody was there. It was just an amazing time.
Roxy,
why weren't you invited? We didn't know who you were yet.
It's not fair.
You would have been invited to this, though.
Thank 100%. You so much.
But one of the last big ones that we were doing, we didn't have a place to throw it. So Eric, who always was like, I don't know where to do it this year. St. Nick's isn't really around anymore. And Bonnie goes,
fallen
I'll do
giant.
It. That's right. Bonnie goes, I'll do it at my house.
Yeah.
There's this house in Venice. It was chaos.
Absolute pandemonium.
The chaos. Best. It was, I mean,
the
every.
The best kind of controlled chaos.
Kind of.
Sort of.
That
kind of.
Then lasted all night.
Sex, drugs, rock and roll?
Yes.
If it could happen at a party, it happened at Christmas.
Yeah. To this day, my favorite picture that I have on my phone is the picture from that party. I dressed up in that Santa Claus outfit that was like 9 sizes too small. The pants were like capri pants.
Right.
The jacket came up to here. The beard was just attached to the hat and was just a string of felt. It was the most hideous Santa outfit ever. I woke up on the sidewalk in Venice with like the sun hitting me in that Santa Claus costume next to my car. Like, I knew I wasn't going to drive home, right. And I just was like, I can't.
Is that where you ended up?
Yes. Everybody was still like,
I don't think that was Chrismukkah.
It was Chrismukkah, dude.
Yeah, it was.
Yes.
Because
I thought I rode home with you.
Why
you
would he not. Be in the outfit?
No, because I remember
I
this.
I rode home with him on that.
He disappeared at one point.
Yep.
Right.
And we were like, asking, like, Macuga just like, party, 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 and then Irish goodbye.
That's a Macuga classic, though.
Yeah, the Irish goodbye.
Disappeared. Yeah. I remember specifically.
You're trying to find the picture.
Yeah, Adam Winkleman's now wife, Whitney, who's the best, Tiny Canal Cottage.
Yeah.
It was one of the greatest party friends you can ever, ever have.
She was good.
I adore her. She is the best.
I'll tell you, the first time I met her, I got hammered at your ex-wife's birthday party.
Oh,
you were there.
All right.
Was I?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
I don't know if you can see this on camera. Riley's in the background of this picture.
Yeah.
Well,
there I am.
You know what we'll do? Let's post this. Macuga, post this on your Instagram. Can you post it on
Instagram? Yeah, I'll post on the Instagram.
And then we'll see that. I'd like to see the picture.
That glass isn't beer. That is whiskey with no ice. It's just a glass of whiskey.
Whose hand is on?
That's Whitney Morris. Whitney Lee Morris. Adam Winkleman's wife. He's like, I was like, show to this. I'm taking, I don't know. That it was just pan, and that was at probably like 3 in the morning.
Oh, right.
Wow.
Yeah, I remember.
Miss partying.
Yeah, there were a lot of. There was good. I mean, there was a picture. I remember there was Tiffany Smith was there. I mean, everybody. Yeah. Was
no
there.
Way.
Everybody was there.
Tiff parties.
Yeah,
Tiff was
I don't
partying.
Know about anymore, but back
Riley
then,
with his writer's scarf that he always used to wear.
Oh yeah, it's almost scarf weather. It's coming out.
But Chrismukkah is coming back this year, but not in the way that you know it. I got an email that it's like the small, because the way Chrismukkah started was friends from school to where we would do these ridiculous gifts. It would start the day, and we had a lot of fun. What was the chant that they used to say? Sorry. Best gift. I can't remember what it was, but there was all these chants would start, and all the craziness would happen.
It was pandemonium.
But this is before you guys.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
It was like just the core group, and then it was just we started having a lot of drinks. But I would invite some people over, and then it just grew and grew and grew. But then we always had the core group give away the gifts and have that little ceremony beforehand, and then boom. So this year they're doing the little ceremony part of it. I don't know if it'll turn into anything, but I couldn't survive a Chrismukkah, I think, at my
really?
Age. Yeah.
Not anymore, yeah.
I could my still age? Put in the effort, but it would be rough till about Tuesday.
It would be tough. Yeah. You guys didn't get a chance to experience it, but man, if you could go back in time, go to a Chrismukkah party. All right, we are still going into news here. By the way, Coy Jandreau.
Jandreau?
Who is the...
is that what we're calling him?
Is that
Coy Jandreau? I don't know. I never know.
I would say
Coy
Jandreau.
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 Jandreau. Jandreau.
Coy is coming in at 11, and we're going to do the preview of the... there's more movies coming out in December. So other things that we're still...
There's a lot.
There's a lot of stuff coming out still. Creed comes out this weekend.
What is it, French?
But there's stuff that we want to see. And we're going to talk to Coy about it. But we still got other news going on. What are you tweeting? Are you doing the Instagram picture?
No, I'm tweeting.
Right.
I'm going to tweet it.
Macuga's going to tweet the Chrismukkah picture. So go to his Twitter.
Make sure you tag
and
him.
Hashtag and hashtag Collider Live.
Yeah.
All right. What do you got?
Snelling and Jay Williams.
Since we're going to talk about movies that are coming out. One movie is coming out. Everybody was wondering about it. I kind of called it. I kind of figured. What Robin Hood has awful reviews.
Oh, yeah. Brett, I want you saw this movie last night. Tell me your review of it.
Oh, Robin Hood?
Yeah, tell me what you think.
So what do you think?
Is this
You know, I just don't. I didn't know what was going on. I was so confused.
Yeah, yeah.
Did I wish I would have seen the
saw
first.
Last night. We sent them last night.
Yeah, yeah. The first. I didn't see the prequel, so I didn't. I was lost for most of the time, and right. like people were shooting arrows. I'm like, why is this guy got so many arrows? It was strange. Right. It was a weird.
Didn't and there's work. So many hoods.
No, that hood. So and how many hoods?
But I heard the music. It was really strange music.
Yeah, it was weird that they would put like modern hip hop into yeah. something like this. Yeah. I didn't think that it
Brett,
would be.
What did you think of? Actual Robin Hood.
Actual Robin Hood?
Right.
It wasn't, he's not my, that's not my Robin
not
Hood.
Not your Robin Hood.
Basically, right. you know, right. I mean.
But you went in with high hopes.
Yeah, I mean, of all the 75 Robin Hood movies right. they've made in the right. last 10 years, this one was going to be the best for me.
Topher Grace has an appearance or no?
I mean, that actually saved that part of the movie when Topher showed up.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, I mean, it was like, at least there's
on
one
that.
Good right. thing. Oh, yeah, spoiler.
Spoiler because there's the post credits.
Yeah.
And I heard this actually ties into the Spider-Man universe.
Yeah, it's right towards the end. That ties it all together, and I was like, it was a little out of place, but right. I'm kind of excited about okay. it.
Any nope. link with Kingsman?
No Kingsman links.
Well, say no. Say that one Easter egg.
Oh, there's an Easter egg.
Yeah, it's I mean, same, it was more tongue in cheek. Right.
It's
kind
the
of a
same
link.
Universe.
Was,
let me tell you something. The movie yeah. that you just said is probably better than the real movie that was on touch. Jeff Brett did not see the movie, but yeah. Nobody saw that movie.
I had to wave Christian down to ask.
Yeah.
I don't know.
It's
when
we
you guys are
it.
Making
oh, we
bits.
That,
yeah. It's not
I don't
a,
know.
You caught the look? Oh, okay. Well.
Roxy, my goal one day is that you'll just go with it. And, and that you'll just... You'll add to it,
hashtag,
and then and we'll yeah. all just be like, "Woo!"
She did add to it.
I added yeah. once I knew.
Yeah, hashtag. Yeah.
But, you know, if that's your goal, I could do it for
okay,
you.
Okay, I'm excited for
hashtag potato fart.
Yeah.
I don't get it.
I don't... It's, those words somebody, are so strange.
Somebody I love quoted that back. He goes, yeah, you know what? He really is a potato fart. Yeah, and no. I'm just like that.
I can't wait for the day when someone says, hey, did you hear what the potato fart said next? Yeah.
Do you see, by the way, that's a follow-up to the news. The Stan Lee's estate responded
oh,
and
good.
Sent well, a big old long, you know, well, they thought they
Belmar.
Very strong wording of like, you know, you don't get it. And
suck
in
my
fact,
dick, basically.
He did basically yeah. suck my dick.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Did anybody read Elliot Dubé's tweet
no.
about it?
His tweets are phenomenal.
He's
by
fantastic.
Way.
Oh, I don't yeah. follow him. I've got it.
Savage.
Awesome. Yeah. yeah. That's why he's a
what did he
bear.
Say?
So he said, if you didn't like Bill Maher's opinion on Stan Lee, you should listen to all of his other terrible opinions on things. I was like, yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Bill Maher is fine. I used to watch his show, and then after like 3 weeks, I was like, I get it. Yeah. It's just a super left leaning pandering.
Well, but that's what he did with Stan Lee wasn't left.
No,
he was just
a donk take.
He's a douche.
Yeah,
he is a potato fart.
He is a potato fart.
I don't like it. It's not. Stop trying to make fetch happen.
Yeah,
it's working so far.
Yeah,
it's not.
Yeah, it worked more than
fans
twat take. I'll tell you
it.
That.
Twat takes worked really well.
What about?
Everybody knows.
No. What about? Can we call him a
so
firework
brave.
Hammer?
What is it?
Firework hammer.
Fireworking.
Firework hammer.
Hashtag it firework
so
hammer.
Potato fart.
He's a human.
What else we got out there?
Guess what? John Chicken Williams milk. Penned an original score for Star
oh, yes.
Wars Land.
Yes. Mm. This is a story that came out about a week ago, but I'll still talk about it on
yeah,
show.
Because that's how slow news is.
Deep cut,
yeah.
deep
but
cut.
I did want to get to because yeah. people are, that's very exciting.
It is.
Very exciting.
Yeah.
You're going to take your kids?
I'll take Vivi. To when it opens next year for sure. It's going to be a little bit before the little one can go. But
do you know that's what... Nick Scarpino's brother does. He is
takes kids to Star Wars.
No. He's
you can get arrested for that.
All right. Yeah.
that's his job. He basically is putting together the light scheme for Star Wars Land
oh, cool.
based on the John Williams score.
Oh yeah. Wow.
So he, you know, like he does all the like the huge Christmas things. He puts together that whole production with that. That's Scarpino's brother. He built their like their LED screen behind it, kind of funny that you can like interchange everything in. He's super talented guy, and he works at Disney.
That's
he does
awesome.
That whole thing.
That's
and
awesome. Yeah, I'm really looking forward to that. I mean, for the obvious reasons, but I think that they're putting so much effort into it. They showed even in that John Williams video, it was clever because it, not only here's the score, but it's like and also a layout of the whole freaking park.
It's so big.
It's crazy.
It's huge.
It? It's awesome. I cannot wait for that park to open. I'm hoping they do a preview night.
How long do you think those lines are going to be?
Oh my god!
Don't go for the first 2 years.
No. Yeah, I know.
Don't.
Well, I know.
I'm hoping for a preview
What's
night.
A preview night
yeah.
look like?
I mean, it just means that you know they.
Can I come?
I mean, we got to ask. Well,
here's the only time that you could probably go, Cobbster, and you're a Disneyland, you know, fanatic or
I
whatever.
Love
you
Disney.
You
yeah.
go.
Yeah.
My sister-in-laws have season passes,
me
all
too.
That kind of stuff.
Josh
do you
hates
really?
It.
Oh man, I will never touch that place.
I know.
But Disneyland.
Amanda can take the kids when we have them. It's fine.
Yeah.
But I think on like a Wednesday morning at 10 a.m., you could probably like check out Star Wars for and be okay.
Maybe.
Well, I don't know.
You got to find like a rainy day or something. Yes. You know, I mean, like,
eventually,
if you have passes.
Cobbster's not wrong. It's going to be jammed for the first like year, 2 years. Right. And then there'll be the days of like, I can go. It's slow season now, right?
Would that be worth it to you to get that like front of the line expensive pass to do the Star Wars
100%,
thing?
100%. Yeah, okay. Because for the longest time, I didn't do the Disneyland Star Tours. And I don't like, I actually don't like Star Tours. I'm one of the few, only because I get motion sickness. Because the actual footage and stuff is amazing. But I come out like I get zipped around those stupid teacups, too. I don't need to do
that. What about when they did for Space Mountain, Star Wars-y?
I didn't get a chance to do it. Yeah, I know. Oh, I heard it was great.
That was fun.
It was
super fun.
Yeah.
But anyway.
You went?
Yeah. Well, so when Ellis and I did the Central Intelligence DVD release, which was one of the most fun, like, 36 hours we ever did, Warner Brothers took us to Disneyland, which is
Warner
hysterical.
Brothers took you to Disneyland.
And, like, the all-expenses-paid tour. And we got, like, front-of-the-line passes, and we had a tour guide and everything, which is crazy. It was amazing. So we went to the front of the line of every ride, and that's the only way I'd ever do that.
Wait, can I ask you guys a question about Warner Brothers that I should probably know the answer to, but I'm just so confused about?
Their PR department is amazing.
Why does Harry Potter exist at Universal?
Yeah. I think because Warner Brothers doesn't have a park, so I think you get the Looney Tunes.
So do they license it?
Yeah. Because there's a lot of stuff inside of that Universal. They have a lot of Warner Brothers
stuff.
Yeah,
they have a lot of. Yeah. But yeah, then like they have a whole... Like,
yeah, it's a license.
And also and Six Flags.
Yeah.
Like Six Flags, they license out the Batman, all like the Justice League rides and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
That's at Six Flags.
Yeah, I'm going to take...
Why don't they make a park?
Well, we're going to go to...
There's no money in it.
There's no money in it?
There's no money in parks.
Yeah.
They
what?
Lose.
Disney makes so much money.
No, they don't.
Yeah.
Really?
I was looking up. Disney Parks makes about 20% of what Disney makes a year.
You don't believe it?
Whoa. If they can close a Disney park, it means they're probably not making a lot of money.
Who can close a Disney park?
Like close overseas one?
Euro Disney, yeah.
Euro Disney, yeah.
The one here makes $1 million a day, supposedly.
A net, maybe in gross. You gotta look at revenues.
Somebody Google this. I could just be spewing nonsense, but I don't think I am.
I want to say, I think
income.
The parks business is pretty big for them.
But what I'm saying is, for Warner Brothers to take all their properties and open up a park.
No money in that.
Yes, right. that's a big risk. Yeah. So it's easier for them to license out stuff. But Brett and I are going to take kids to. I still haven't been to Harry Potter.
Yeah,
too.
I went finally for the first time.
Is
it
great?
Was dope.
Yeah, I want to go.
And we have so many friends that work there. So
I know. I think we're gonna go. We're gonna probably go in the next week or so.
It's good at Christmas time. I'm sure it's like amazing.
I love it. As of 2016, the United States 6.2 million per day per park. It grosses a combined 13.6 billion from the six domestic parks annually.
Yeah. And what percentage of that?
Yeah, what is that revenue?
I don't know. I'm just Googling
it. It's gross.
It seems like a lot of money.
Hold on. Sorry. Galaxy Edge is opened, and then,
Oh, the other thing, by the way, I know we talked about it briefly, that Wreck-It Ralph experience it went to. We're going to be doing the Star Wars one for Jedi. We got it confirmed. It's me, Ken, Reilly,
Roxy.
And Fernandez. You're not Jedi. Do you want to go do it, too?
Can I come?
Do you really want to go to every store?
Did you get the re-invite for the Wreck-It Ralph?
I'm looking into it. Jack's supposed to look into Dorian. I know you're listening right now. Ask Jack what the hell's going on.
Dorian.
Yeah.
They did this Wreck-It Ralph VR, and it seems like in this place they only like to make me do VR that makes me faint or cry or scream or lose my voice. But they went and Kristian comes back and says, "Dude, the Wreck-It Ralph VR is perfect. It's amazing." It's like, "Oh man, thanks for the invite. I only sacrificed my body for you and your VR content. It's okay, no worries."
I've never
done it.
Is it amazing?
This VR that we play here, is fun. This is next level. This is next level stuff. Like you can't. The one that we have here, you can't walk, right? You have to like push like. You just got to push. Your character will walk if you hit like the scroll up, you know, which is fun and it's cool. And there's some great VR that we have and that we've played here.
Yes,
but it's next level stuff. You legit walk and see other people in character, and it's
that's so
awesome.
Cool.
I think I
get wish
sick.
I would have taken it. No, not this.
I got sick doing one of these. Like, got $100 to do a car simulator thing. Whatever came out of that.
No. You wouldn't, dude. I get sick on these things. Like I was just saying, Star Tours, like easily, you would absolutely not get sick. It's just like you're walking around in normal life, but you look up. When you see Wreck-It Ralph 2, you're in the movie. Like you were legit in the movie. Like if you look up, you see like things going back and forth, like in the internet, and you can look around. And it stretches out. It's crazy. Like and it was really, really impressive. And we're gonna be doing the Star Wars one soon. But
Can't
yeah,
wait.
Jack. If you are listening, what's going on with that Wreck-It Ralph? Can we go again? We want to go. All right, let's do some more news before we go to break.
Nothing. Well, it's really slow, but I wanted to maybe throw this out there. We just put up on Collider.com ranking every single Disney animated movie.
Oh, okay.
Can you guys call the top five?
Ooh, calling the top five?
Yeah.
Beauty and the Beast has to be number one.
Okay, you think that's...
I would say Beauty and the Beast is number one.
Did you say, is this animated in general?
Yeah, all Pixar? The animated movies. Pixar.
Does Zootopia
count? Yeah, Zootopia, Bolt.
Frozen,
right.
What was number one?
We don't know yet. We're predicting.
Yeah, I'm going to play this game.
So I'm going to go, I'll be off, but I'll say Beauty and the Beast is number one.
Lion King.
Yeah, Lion King's probably, Lion King might be number one.
Number one.
Brer Rabbit.
Aladdin.
Beauty, hold your list. Hold your list.
Yeah.
Beauty and the Beast, Aladdin, excuse me, Beauty and the Beast, Lion King, Aladdin, Frozen, and then Little Mermaid.
Okay, now, all Disney movies. So we have your Snow Whites, your Cinderellas, your Sleeping Beauties, Pinocchios, Dumbos.
Who did this list?
I got to go back to the top. Yeah, Collider did it, but it's a...
Oh, they don't know what they're talking about.
Yeah.
No, they made the list.
Drew Taylor, one of our freelancers.
Wait, they made these movies?
I don't know Drew's taste, so we'll see. What do you think?
Oh, I thought you were saying it was a vote. I think Lion King's number one.
Okay.
I think Aladdin's probably number two, possibly because those are my two favorite.
Okay. Three, four, and five. And know your list when I come to you.
I don't know if Beauty and the Beast is on there.
Okay, so only one ever nominated for an Academy Award.
Yeah, but what is it? Favorite or best?
Best.
Yeah, it's the best.
Okay, maybe Beauty and the Beast.
So, like, rankings.
Yeah, Beauty and the Beast, Frozen also, Mulan?
Okay. Macuga, hit it.
I'm going to go Cinderella.
Okay, number one.
Lion King.
Okay.
Beauty and the Beast. Little Mermaid. The Disney Fox Robin Hood.
Little Mermaid.
Oh. See, you're going emotion there. I'm with you on it, but no chance. Mm. All right, what do you got?
I'm going Macuga and Robin Hood. That's my favorite.
Yeah, that's
my
favorite. So is that number
one? And then Frozen, definitely.
So Robin Hood's number one for you?
No, not number one, but it's I mean, I don't think it's going to be, but God, that was so good. Yeah, Robin Hood, Frozen. I'm going to say Sleeping Beauty
is number one.
Just because it's like been around. Isn't that the oldest one?
Yeah, so Sleeping Beauty is number one. No,
Snow White. That's what I want to say. Snow White.
Okay. Bambi.
I'll throw Bambi in. I'll take them.
Dumbo?
Then Dumbo. Yeah, I'll go all the classics. So
underrated Dumbo.
All right, Riley, give us what was the list?
At number five.
Yes.
Beauty and the Beast.
Wow. Okay. Wow. All right, I'm out.
Number four.
Yeah.
Bambi.
Wow, it really did make it.
I don't like this list so far.
Yeah. Number three, Fantasia.
Oh, Fantasia
is
the most overrated anime.
This is why I wanted to bring it up.
Yeah. No.
Number two, Sleeping Beauty.
Sleeping Beauty.
Sleeping Beauty. Mm-hmm.
And number one, Pinocchio.
Oh,
no.
So no Lion King, no Aladdin in the top five?
I just lost it.
Yeah, no.
When the Lion King was at seven.
This is one person's list.
Yeah. Who's at six? Yeah.
Peter Pan is at number eight. At six is Dumbo.
But I got to tell you, this is why these lists are always so controversial.
Like
always.
Dumbo.
A matter of if we do
Look
them
at our top 10 horror.
Every
Look
single out. Time, because this is what people don't realize, too. It's not a matter of, like, when you put these lists out, it's like, oh, that's what Collider thought. They are, like, scraps. Like, I would fight. Who did the list again?
Drew Taylor.
I would fight with Drew Taylor on this to the end of time. I don't think any of those movies should have been in the top five, except
Is it
the
one Beast. Person who made this, though? Did Drew just... This is Drew's just personal
his.
Opinion.
That's just his.
I think this is also a repost. We've done this. We're putting them out there every time, every year.
I think that's a crazy list.
I think it's a shame. I know this makes Cobbster probably shudder because doing that whole top 10 horror thing is tough. But we should do a top 10 holiday movie top 10 because it's super fun.
Yeah, I just don't think they pull views, unfortunately. Yeah. We talked about it. There are other ones. The ones that I really want to do, and you talk about fisticuffs trying to get it made, is the top 10 Star Wars movies. Fernandez won't do it because and to his credit, the man loves Episode 3. He loves it.
It's like his favorite.
It's his favorite Star Wars movie. Yeah. In no world do I live in does that movie make the top five.
No.
In no world.
Nope.
And to him, he'd put it at number two. And in no world where
What's
he was.
What's number one?
His number one's...
What do you mean? It's Revenge of the Sith.
Last Jedi.
For him is Revenge of the Sith. He loves it.
Yeah.
But he would be okay if Revenge of the Sith dropped down like two or three. And it just... In the collective, he knows it. There's no chance. And he really despises Last Jedi.
Oh, yeah.
And that... Because if that movie hit anywhere in the top five,
Which I think it would.
The internet would
collectively.
Blow up. Yeah. Yeah. So it's a very divisive topic that we haven't.
Huh.
I wanted to do
top
it.
Five.
I'd love to do it. My top five right now: Empire Strikes Back, New Hope, Force Awakens.
Really?
Rogue One.
What?
Yeah, Last Jedi's way down for me. I don't really love it. And then, what am I missing? Did I miss Return of the Jedi? I said Return of the Jedi.
Yeah, you didn't.
Oh, I didn't. I'm sorry. So,
Return of the Jedi. That's what I'm saying.
I'm sorry. Let me do it again. So it's Empire Strikes Back, New Hope, Force Awakens, Return of the Jedi, and then Rogue One.
Force Awakens is your third favorite Star Wars movie.
Whoa. Absolutely.
Wow, I do not feel that way.
Yeah, that's fair.
This is the fun part of the thing. Yeah. All right, so in like a similar vein, right? On this Friday, the Friday after Thanksgiving, Tiger Woods and Phil Mickelson are playing a match, like a pay-per-view golf match that's really never been done before. We haven't seen anything like this. Is there something in the movie or TV world that you would pay like $20 pay-per-view to see some kind of like, you know, here is this match, or here is these two people going at it, like a debate or a this is.
It has to be now or at any time in history.
At any time in history.
Tyson versus Holyfield.
Okay.
I mean, no, Tyson versus Muhammad Ali.
You'd pay 20. I mean, you'd
but that's
obviously
sports.
Pay
you meant?
Yeah.
Oh,
no, I'm saying in
Star
TV
Wars.
Or movies,
oh,
like
TV
in,
or movie.
Or like whatever.
It's Tyson versus Ali in their prime.
Okay.
Harry versus Voldemort at the end of.
See, that would be kind of fun,
that'd
right?
Be pretty dope.
Like
yeah,
if this was real world, right? And you're like, we're paying, a character.
So which movie? So you do a boxing match inside a film?
No. I'm just saying like
Clubber Lang versus Rocky.
Sure, something
right.
like that.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. Clubber Lang versus Rocky, the second fight. I would want to watch that.
See, I like Cobbster where he went fantasy and like we've got to pay pay-per-view $150 to watch Voldemort and Harry Potter go at
Obi-Wan
it.
Obi-Wan versus Vader in the Death Star. Yes. I'm there for
that could be
front
dope,
fucking
right?
row.
I don't know. Well, but you pick like Nicki Minaj and like Paris Hilton.
That would be pretty fun.
To fight each other? Yeah. Yeah. But again, this is what VR. When I did this Wreck-It Ralph VR, it's limitless of what they're going to be able to do. In 10 or 15 years.
Well, the Creed video game, remember we were playing that? That was awesome.
I'm telling you, this is nothing compared to this Wreck-It Ralph thing. And I love that Creed thing. You'll be able to sit down there. And I see all these ads now on Facebook, too, to where you can, if you're at your place doing whatever, and we could sit down and go watch a movie together. We'll be in the same, even if you're at your house, I'm at my house, in the same room, sitting there talking to each other and watching the movie. There's going to be so many new things.
So great to not have any human contact like that.
Why but isn't they are, porn is, taking over that whole world?
It's starting to. They have that as well, too. It's
porn?
There's
you'd think, like...
Yeah, it already is. Yeah. There's so much stuff that...
That I know of.
Nice. What was that, Cobbster? Perfect. I think that's it for right now, right? And then we'll go to break. When we get back, Coy Jandreau is here. We're going to do the December 2018 movies, things that we want to see, what we hope to see, if we've heard anything about the movies we want to check out. And you guys should chime in and let us know, too. And then, 11:30, director of Creed 2, Steven Caple Jr. is live in studio, and we're going to talk to him about the movie Macuga didn't see last night. Bye.
No, it's not late to the party. That's actually from Obi-Wan Kenobi. You didn't know that? Well, you should, and now you do. Jedi Council. What is it? It's about Star Wars, obviously. It's Jedi Council. Every week, the latest and greatest in Star Wars movie news, myself and Ken Napsok, that's right, the pit boss himself, we have a guest on, and we talk about everything happening in the world of Star Wars. If it's the movie news, the TV news, canon news, comic books, games, and then we take questions from you guys on Facebook and Twitter. It's a lot of fun. We've been doing it for a couple of years now. I'm still excited talking about it. The fan base is coming together again. I believe it is. I think it is. I hope it is. And we're talking Star Wars, so we'd like you. That's right, all of you. If you're not a fan of Star Wars, come on over and join us every Thursday for Collider Jedi Council here on Collider Video. And we have an Apple Podcast feed or Podcast One, wherever you want to go if you listen to podcasts. And not only do you get Collider Jedi Council every week on Thursday, The Rule of Two with Mark Fernandez and Mark Reilly, that's on every week. I believe it drops on Wednesday. It's on one of these days. It's a good show. You should listen to it. I like it. I listen to it. I haven't listened to it once.
Hey, guys. Ryan Satin here from ProWrestlingSheet.com. And if you're a pro wrestling fan, which I hope you are. Even if it's in secret, then you should be checking out Wrestling Sheet Radio Weekly. We've got a bunch of shows in the podcast feed. We've got weekly recaps from myself and John Rocha, which you guys will probably know from the Collider family. That's for Raw. That's for SmackDown. We've also got the weekly roundup of wrestling news. It's a show I host called Wrestling Sheet Radio with Jamie Iovine and Elijah Bates. And we've also got a bunch of other stuff in our YouTube channel, youtube.com/C/wrestling sheet. So check it out, subscribe, and I hope you guys dig it.
Hey everyone, Mark Ellis here. You know, when I'm not trying to clone dinosaurs or drinking at my neighborhood watering hole, I am probably hosting Collider Movie Talk. It's a flagship show here at Collider. I like to say that because I'm the host of it. It's every day, almost. It's 4 days a week, which is still pretty good, above 50%. You can watch it Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. 4 p.m. Los Angeles time is when we do it. It's live, so you can participate in the live chat room. Go ahead and give us your thoughts on every story we have coming, because it's all the latest movie news of the day. Who did what at the box office? What horrible Redbox movies Bruce Willis signed on to? The DC, the Marvel, the Star Warses, the Lord of the Rings. Are they making new? I think it's a TV show, and we still might talk about it anyway, because we love movies around here. It's myself and an expert panel of guests, including John Rocha, Perry Nemiroff, Jeff Snyder, and other noted noters of note. You guys are going to love this show, and then we take your live Twitter questions at the end of the show at Collider Video. You can always use the hashtag Collider Movie Talk to get in touch with us, so subscribe right here to Collider Video. Check out Movie Talk, and check out the Collider Movie Talk podcast feed. We have a podcast feed now. You don't have to look at this handsomeness. You can just listen to it, whether you're driving to work, whether you're driving from work, or you don't have a job, but you have a basement and ears. You can listen to Collider Movie Talk's feed. You can get it at Apple Podcasts or on iTunes. You also get Mailbag. That's the show that's hosted by Perry Nemiroff a lot more professionally than I run this pirate ship. That's our weekend show where she takes your letters. I don't know if you write them or you email them. You have to ask her. And Afterthoughts, hosted by Ryan Snelling and Jay Williams. I almost said Ryan Williams and Jay Snelling. Would anybody have known the difference? I certainly would. I would have felt bad about it, because I'm a nice person, and that's why I host Collider Movie Talk. Check it out in video form or on our podcast feed.
What's up, Collider fans? If you are a fan of television and you want to watch a guy that looks like me and a guy named Thad Williams talk about TV every single Friday, subscribe to the Collider channel. Collider Podcast is where you can find the video. We have our own iTunes feed, hashtag Collider TV Talk. You can find on iTunes or wherever you find your podcasts and you listen to them in your ear holes. That's where Collider TV Talk comes at you. We talk about TV news. We talk about shows we love, shows that we don't love. And most importantly, we don't read any books, because TV has nothing to do with reading. We also have a show called Hypothetical Questions with myself and Roxy Striar, and all kinds of reviews right here at the Collider Podcast channel and the Collider TV Talk feed. Subscribe, rate, like, tell your friends, tell all your friends to tell their friends, and before you know it, it's a pyramid scheme of television. I'm Josh Macuga. You can see Thad Williams and myself along with Roxy Striar and all the Collider personalities all the time right here on Collider TV Talk. As always, put down the book, pick up the remote.
Hey everyone, I'm Scott Movie Mance, and just to let you know, if you already don't, every Friday here on Collider Video, I host a weekly film review series called Movie Review Talk. The title says it all. Every week I'm joined by two guest critics of my choice, and they're never the same. We review the new films. We pick something that's streaming that you might not know about, but is really great. And we pick a Blu-ray for something that you might have missed in theaters. It is fun. It is infectious. It is the Citizen Kane of movie review shows. And it's only right here on Collider with this guy, Scott Movie Mance, Mr. Movie Release Dates himself. Check it out every Friday at 10 a.m. Pacific, only on Collider Video.
Collider Live, we are back. It is Tuesday as we get ready for Turkey Day coming up pretty soon here. Fun little crew. We got Roxy Striar, Josh Macuga, Mark Riley, and joining us at the table, He is the co-host of Collider Heroes, and he's here to talk some movies with us. Hello, Coy Jandreau. How are you, my man? Good
doing
to see
good.
You.
Good to be here.
First, we've been trying to get you on for a little bit.
Yeah.
Finally getting you on to
he's
talk some...
He's a busy, busy, busy person.
Who can guess... I know what it's from. Who can guess what it's from? What she just did there.
Busy, busy,
busy, busy, busy.
Gremlins 2.
No.
It's kind of close.
This is why I manage now.
No.
Rapid retention.
This is from the Frosty the Snowman.
Frosty the Snowman.
Oh, it's topical and everything.
It is. Absolutely. Well done. All right. So Coy is here because there are movies coming out in December that we are looking forward to. There's a lot of good ones, a lot of movies with some hype behind it. And here's some of the movies we're going to talk about. The first one, the obvious, let's look right here. Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse comes out. Hearing a lot of buzz on this one. Did you get a chance to see it yet?
I'm seeing it this week.
You are? Okay. Because there was a screening last night.
There was a Creed and that screening last night. Right. I missed both with work. So both. I was like, yeah. But yeah, it was a rock hard place and no visibility.
You know what you could have done with your Creed screening? You could have invited me.
I could have. You know, I could have just boxed into that one, swung into the next one, but missed everything.
Let me ask you a question, though. Don't you have contacts? I mean, Warner Brothers is doing the international, but they know people.
They didn't. They did not know people.
I have no
idea. Warner Brothers was... I love them so much. They couldn't.
Can't help you on that one.
They wrote back to me. We're dying to go.
I found out 30 minutes before that it was happening, and it wasn't by way of invite. It was by way of I'm going. And I was thanks.
I understand. But Spider-Verse is coming out. We did get invites to that. I am also seeing it next week.
When's it coming out?
It comes out on December 14th, and it's Lord and Miller who are doing it.
So it's going to be a comedy.
I mean, it's comedic. I mean, Spider-Man, by his nature, has a lot of comedic moments. But what do you think about this one?
I like that they moved it up. It was originally coming out the 21st. I thought it was a smart move to move it to the 14th.
Way smarter.
And, like, it's the first cinematic Miles Morales, so it's got a great market.
Right.
But they're smart to include all these other iterations of Spider-Man because it's the appeal of toys and kids and everything else. And the animation, I think, is the first time in my adult life going like, oh, that is something I've never seen before. Yeah. They always say like you've never seen, but this is using pixels in a way I've never actually, the textures.
It looks like a comic book coming to life.
Yeah.
And I dug what I've seen so far, and the script, they showed a lot of stuff at Comic-Con. They did at the end of Venom. There's some stuff. What's going on, Macuga?
I'm just looking up who the voice is.
Jake Johnson.
Jake Johnson is Spider-Man.
Oh, cool. Miles Morales.
Shamik Moore is Miles Morales.
From Dope, right?
From Dope, yeah. He is Miles Morales.
And he's a doll face, too. He's so sweet.
Yeah, so
Liev Schreiber is Kingpin.
That one I've never heard is before. That, I've heard his name pronounced a lot of different ways.
Yeah.
Liev is a new...
L-I-E-V.
Liev.
Yeah.
Did you just call him Liev Schreiber?
He's a living man. He's a Liev Schreiber.
But you knew it was. Okay, so Schmodown rules. What would have just happened?
Liev Schreiber would not count.
But what if he spelled it accurately?
If he spelled it L-I-E-V... But then
I spelled it right.
Yes, so then it would have.
Wow.
Yeah, it would have.
Controversy begins.
I would have judged that on
because I knew the name.
Because you see
the information.
But if you said Liev Schreiber and wrote L-I-V-E, then that's a totally different person.
Fair,
that's Lena Headey all over again.
Yeah.
And it's also just
you know that her name is not Headey, right?
Yes.
I have her IMDb up here, guys. Let me break this down.
Is it Headey or Headey? I don't know.
It's Headey.
Is it Headey?
It's an ongoing dilemma.
So it's Headey.
Like Corey Jandreau. I'm like, that's not my name. I mean, I get it. That's fair. When I'm called Corey, I'm like,
I see. I don't think it's the Corey part. I always thought it was either Jandreau.
Oh, dude, there's so
many. Jandreau? What's right?
It's Jandreau. It's the easiest version. It's pretty easy, but it's every vowel. So people just...
Jandreau?
I think French Canadian? It's more Jan than Meriden. Jean.
Jan and Jean.
Because it's more Jan than Jean for me, but now I need to go Jandreau instead of Jandreau.
But I have no French blood. Like, it's married in French, so people meet me and they're like, that doesn't even make sense.
It's like LaCroix, not LaCroix.
Yeah. Right. This is America. We say things how we
croissant, not croissant.
Right.
Croissant.
All right. So everybody, I think, is looking forward to Spider-Verse.
So much money.
I think so, too, but I am a little nervous about its drop-off because Bumblebee, Aquaman.
Next week.
Yeah. So
Aquaman's actually the same week. Aquaman is the day before. Aquaman's the day before. Spider-Verse comes out the 14th. Aquaman comes out December
13th.
No, 21st.
Aquaman's the same as Bumblebee.
Well, I have the wrong thing.
I think it's the 21st. Aquaman. You got it.
Let's double check.
But that is internationally.
This is international?
Internationally,
well, thank you, Riley.
Aquaman
I appreciate
does
that.
Come out earlier, so maybe that's what that is.
All right. Well, that's incorrect information I have.
Okay. Hey, that website, led me wrong.
What's the website?
21st, So they moved it up.
But is Spider-Man still on the 14th?
Spider-Man is still on the 14th.
I'm saying for the drop-off because then the first week it's good that they moved because now they're not competing. But then the second week to go against...
Heavy hitters.
There's
a lot of heavy hitters coming up because I don't know if this is right or not, but you got Aquaman, Bumblebee, and Mary Poppins. Boom, boom, boom.
I think Poppins is 2 days before.
Yeah,
right?
Mary Poppins
is the 19th.
19th.
And I'm seeing that next week.
Me too.
And that's the same demographic. Like, that's all the young... Adults/children and parents bringing their kids crowd, all of it.
So many spoons of sugar.
Is that, yes, I would like to see Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse make money, all and whatever, but
I don't think it cracks 60 million opening weekend.
No way.
Right?
No,
because
chance.
It's
because of all these no other
chance.
Things.
No chance.
I feel like
million.
It'll go opening 50. Weekend?
I think it could hit 60 opening weekend.
No chance.
Because, first of all, it's really important that this movie does well because there aren't that many movies like this right now. Yeah. And if this can perform, then we can go into a whole different area. But second of all, it's not like that opening weekend it's going against the heavy hitters. I think if it makes 60, the next weekend it might make 12.
I think 45. It makes 45 to 50.
I think that's more realistic, but I don't think there's no way it makes 60.
It's Spider-Man, and we just had that game break every record. So Spider-Man high is high.
It doesn't always transfer over into ticket
sales.
It's
the casual fan that won't see this.
That's right.
Do you know what I'm saying? I won't see this. I won't see it until
I think repeat viewers the first weekend.
It matters of reviews. Yeah. I mean, this is going to be word of mouth type stuff, too, because I think, and not just reviews from critics, reviews from fans. I think that it's going to be one of those things to where if it's word of mouth, if it's just one of the most amazing movies in general, no pun intended, because you're right, the next week it's got to do big in its opening weekend because it's going to have heavy hitters. And I'll tell you what, out of those three movies, because I know Mary Poppins
don't
comes
say
out,
Bumblebee, don't say Bumblebee.
Bumblebee's the one I'm looking forward
don't
to.
Don't say Bumblebee.
Yeah. It looks incredible.
If you know my take on the, I am a hardcore Transformers. From the 80s.
Early days.
Yeah. I wanted to do a movie.
I had it on VHS. I had the whole thing.
The 86 version.
That is the easiest
version.
Take anybody's ever had. That is the least hot take I've
ever
heard.
I didn't even finish anything yet.
Yeah.
How did I finish my take?
It's the warm-up.
The fact that you're more of a fan of the
absolutely
earlier
not my take.
Transformers.
That's not my take, but finish my take. No. I want to know.
Well,
I'd love to know.
Hashtag so
will
brave.
Will you take me to
no,
Spider-Verse?
No, you're not getting at this. I want you to finish my take. I was a fan of what else?
You were a fan of it then, and then you were kind of a fan of the first one,
wrong.
But then after that you were not a fan of the series and you're excited for Bumblebee because Bumblebee is one of your favorites and the trailer looked good.
False.
Was that a jab favor? Did you just like insult and then go, can you bring me to Spider-Verse?
No, because she's doing is she heard a take from a lot of different people that was that take exactly and just thought that was my take because of the first
take.
Sentence I took. Now let me take it back. I was a fan of the 80s. I loved the 1986 version. I thought it was the best movie that had ever been made as far as Transformers. It was emotional. It had the right characters to it. I don't think that none of that has ever transformed at all. I thought the first movie sucks.
You hated the first
movie? Everyone else loves the first movie.
I was wrong about that part.
I hate the first movie. I think that when I first got to in Los Angeles, myself and Aaron Wilhelm, the editor of the Schmodown, we wrote a spec script for Transformers. We wanted Transformers to be this really cool, kind of take itself seriously movie that it looks like Bumblebee's going to have moments for sure of humor, but it's taking itself seriously. This was the movie we thought we were going to. We wanted to make, right? And then the first one, the Michael Bay stamp just stunk on all those movies and got progressively worse after each movie, worse and worse and worse. And I was just like, I'm done with this franchise. And then they say Travis Knight's coming along, who I liked, Kubo and the Two Strings. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, well, what do they do?
I could have predicted that.
Then I see the trailer. The trailer itself.
I said
looks
that part.
Like from the 80s, though. It looks like it is all those original designs and the things that I wanted to see from that movie. I'm like, this could be the movie that I actually wanted from the Transformers. This could be the one that just gets all those Michael Bay, that nonsense out of the way and gives me what I want. So I'm excited for that. I think that's my number one most anticipated.
Can we pause for a second?
Yeah.
Okay, pulling the team.
Your take was pretty close.
Pretty close, right?
Pretty
what
close.
I said his take was almost spot
the
on.
The first and third act were there. The second
first
act
maybe.
Well, that's the only thing that matters, right?
You concluded correctly.
Who cares
about the second act?
Yeah, well, the second act makes the movie whether or not you want to stick around for the third.
It's 80 minutes of the movie.
Yeah,
that's
right.
That's when Sex and the City 2 lost you?
It lost me pretty early.
The conflict. The conflict's important.
God, that movie's garbage.
It's so good.
You're going to say Aquaman's your favorite. The one you're looking forward to,
right? I mean,
right?
Here's the deal. I've been hosting DC Movie News for 4 years. Right. What kind of twat am I if that's not the one I'm looking forward to most? But Bumblebee looks damn good, I will say. And I'm a big Poppins girl. So I'm excited for all of them. Aquaman, I'm super nervous. Based off the non-reviews we've seen, I think that this movie is going to be really good.
Yeah.
Like, even though they said nothing, I feel like El Maimbe, Tiffany, those people that were Instagramming being like, can't say anything. I was reading through the lines being like,
big
but
smiles.
It's amazing. Yeah, you know?
Well, she's
body
launch. I mean,
Dorian, I know his opinion on it. I can't
say anything.
I said I know his opinion on it, but I don't know his opinion. I mean, he's never seen any movies that I like.
Right.
So I can't take his opinion on anything. I like Dorian a lot. He hasn't seen anything.
Anything before 2007, I don't think he's seen.
He's a fresh 38.
Yeah.
Yeah. So Aquaman, should we be excited for it?
Aquaman, I think, is a really good opportunity for DC to show their cards, and I think they know that. And I think the reshoots were really intelligent on them. Like, they expanded the reshoots. They gave it more money. I think it's a really Hail Mary throw.
Yeah.
And the last trailer looks amazing. The new trailer dropped yesterday looks the best the movie has. So I feel like everything they're putting into it is the right move. I feel like my Spider-Man bias is really strong, where I don't know if those two audiences will be able to share 8 days. Like, I feel like the animation is going to throw a lot of people off.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, I feel like the 10 million that Spider-Verse will dent will affect Aquaman.
You think so? I don't think Spider-Man's going to hit Aquaman.
It's not going to compete, but yeah, if 10 million, like, say that many people go see Spider-Verse.
You think people will say, I'd rather see Spider-Verse than Aquaman?
Some people.
Really?
I think Bumblebee's going to torch Aquaman. I'm not saying it's going to do better, but I think if Aquaman had that weekend to itself, we're looking at completely different numbers than if it was up against Bumblebee.
I don't disagree with you, because I think that the thing is with Bumblebee, regardless of what I think about the other movies, minus the last one, they really crushed with box office, mm-hmm. right? So there's that
and
audience.
And now this one finally looks good.
Yes, and there's this audience that is still there from mm-hmm. the Transformers movies. And then there's this audience like me of these of the hardcore old school Transformers fans that want to see a good movie. And that you're playing with both worlds, so I think Bumblebee could really make a lot. What do you got, McCooks?
I mean, I was looking more forward to the Bumblebee Arthur movie. It's you know, it's
Shumarani! Shumarani!
Here's the thing. Yeah. I don't think Bumblebee, we're coming into, the marketing looks great, right? Last night, though, was like 500 million less grossing wise than the fourth movie, right?
What, the Transformers?
Transformers. Yeah. So I think there's a little bit the last night.
Wow, yeah. I never knew that.
Yeah, it didn't do as well. So I'm wondering if is going to affect. I think Aquaman's going to win.
I think it's going to win.
Bumblebee is going to be underneath it a bit.
Both franchises have a lot of scorned ex lovers.
True.
And so we'll see how which are more bitter.
Aquaman 80.
Well, I think it's
Bumblebee 65.
Yeah.
Oh, you don't think John Rocco is right, where he's going to hit 200 million opening weekend for Aquaman? No one.
I think
$1.
Lunatic.
I think Mary Poppins wins that whole thing.
You think Mary Poppins is going to win the? Well, Mary Poppins comes out 2 days before, so that's the question we're not really talking about. So what I'm hearing about Mary Poppins, no pun intended here, is that the movie is magic. I hear that it is just an amazing sequel. People
you trust?
People
that
I trust. And
married men are going to be like, I'd like to go to see Aquaman, and the wife's going to be like, we're going to see Mary Poppins, and then you can compromise and you go to see Mary Poppins.
Yeah. And I don't think anybody's going to be.
Or you see Bumblebee. Like, one says one, one says the other.
Okay, my wife loves the Transformers franchise. Are you
joking?
She
likes Hailee Steinfeld.
But is that enough to compliment Mary Poppins?
Hailee Steinfeld isn't pulling my wife to the theater.
Away from Emily Blunt.
I think it's pulling a lot of, maybe not your wife, but a lot of girlfriends.
But I'll tell you though, Mary Poppins though. The thing is that the reason why, going off of your point, that people are going to go out and see this that are not just women, right?
Right.
Like everyone, and I think people are going to love it because Emily Blunt was a brilliant casting choice.
Yeah.
Emily Blunt is an actress.
She's so likable.
She's super likable. She's been in really cool movies for dudes as well, Edge of Tomorrow and Quiet Place.
She's one of the best female action stars of our time.
She's really good. And she transfers. She's a very likable actress, and she's inviting.
It's pretty.
Looper, another one. And so I think that movie is going to speak to families. I think it's going to do really well. What do you think about Mary Poppins? Do you care about it?
I think it's our number one that weekend.
You do?
And I think it's going to hit 90, 95.
Wow.
And then I think 80 for... I think it's going to be a huge weekend in the box office. But I feel like Aquaman's going to be 5, 10 million shy. And then another 15 lower is Bumblebee. And then Spider-Man's going to drop to the 15, 20.
Yeah.
Wow, I really hope that Aquaman beats all of them.
What a crazy weekend
opportunity.
Yeah. God, that's so insane.
And Mary Poppins has a two-day start.
And this is the perfect example of why I like multiple studios owning characters, because I'm worried about the Fox Disney merger for this not existing. I'm worried about I'm glad Venom did well because now Spider-Man stays with Sony.
But why do you want this to exist?
Because I love the fact that there's a weekend where there's four giant movies I can't wait to see, and I love the fact that we're going to have a crazy battle. This is like the Super Bowl. This doesn't happen a lot of weekends, and everyone owned one thing, they wouldn't, like, Disney wouldn't bite its own tail.
Well, that's why Star Wars isn't coming out.
And that's
why there's a Disney movie.
And Sony is Spider-Man. That's what I'm saying. It's just one.
Right.
Sony is Spider-Man because it's their animation side.
Right.
That wouldn't exist with Mary Poppins.
Right.
And that's why I like that Sony has
Spider-Man. How many people do you think go to the movie this weekend, not this current weekend, that weekend, haven't bought tickets, walk in, one thing sold out, they get for the other one. Like, they don't even care what they're seeing. There's just so many. They
it
just
happens
go
a lot at Christmas time. I think that's a lot of times studios hope for that too. I mean, I can't tell you how many times when I would go visit my dad in Florida, and we'd be like, let's go see a movie. Well, let's see whatever's playing. There'd be something out there that we can see. And then we just pick.
Yeah.
And whatever's available.
So people get rollover.
Yeah.
And whatever time is convenient. People like discount the fact you wander in like 4:30 that. Like, and this is another opportunity. Those will be on two screens each. That's 8 screens to 10 screens of opportunity.
Yeah.
That's a lot of time.
Here's it comes down, I think, to a lot is casual fandom, right? Is Mary Poppins has more of a, no pun intended, a pop to the casual eye, right? Yeah. Then you've got Aquaman. I think that's second as far as recognizable things. Third is Spider-Man. And then fourth, you have the Bumblebee. And everybody's like, what's Bumblebee?
What's Bumblebee? Because they're not leading with Transformers, right? Mm-hmm. Right.
Which is smart and stupid.
Yes.
It's a risk.
Yeah.
It's certainly a risk. And but it's just the stupid. The trailers itself, it really looks like E.T.
How to Train Your Dragon.
Yeah. It's got that feel to it, and that's what I'm digging about it. So,
and
I
clearly the studio
crossed.
Trusts it because of the Guardians of the Galaxy rumors.
What's Travis
Knight's front runner for Guardians 3.
Oh right.
So
right,
like that
right.
clearly states the studio's like, this looks amazing. We love the finished product.
Right.
Let's
they've
put
them
in.
They've seen it. So let's see a cut of his movie. Oh wow, he really did it. Yeah. He'll get the idea of what we want trying to go for Guardians.
Maybe
3,
after like what I'm thinking is by January, let's just say mid January, right? What of these, when the dust settles, will have the biggest number? I'm saying Mary Poppins, then probably Aquaman, then probably Bumblebee. Mm-hmm. Or Bumblebee and Spider-Man almost tied it.
You're saying end of run.
End of run.
End of run, I'm going to agree with you on the first one. I think Mary Poppins is the biggest one. I'm going Bumblebee because of word of mouth. I think
Bumblebee's going to do better than Aquaman by the end.
Overall, I think so, yes.
Are you including international or just domestic?
International. These movies crush.
I know, that's why I'm saying. If you just did domestic.
If we just stick to domestic, I still stick with it. I still stick with it. I think that... I feel that the buzz on Bumblebee is going to be pretty big. I think that Aquaman will do better than Bumblebee opening weekend, though.
Yeah,
I think so, too. I think opening weekend it'll be Mary Poppins, Aquaman, Bumblebee,
Spider-Man.
What
we're not accounting for is if one of these is a stinker.
I don't think any one of them is going to be a stinker.
I don't think so either, but if it is, Bumblebee is a stinker.
Well, here's
then
the next.
It's not.
Then you're right. But let's go next prediction here, right? Out of the four of them in quality, because unless you think one of them is going to stink, I don't think anybody thinks any of them is going to stink.
No. Mm-hmm.
Give me quality. Which rank out of the four, what are going to be the best movies out of the four? As far as quality, not box office, as far as quality and enjoyment. Riley, start with you out of the four movies.
I'm going to go Spider-Verse.
It's the number one. Okay.
Number one, quality. Then Mary Poppins Returns, is that in there? Okay. Spider-Verse, Mary Poppins Returns, Bumblebee, Aquaman.
Yeah, all right.
I'm going to jump off a bridge.
What do you think?
You just put Aquaman fourth.
What do you think?
I'm going to put...
Now, what you want. What do you
think? I know. I'm going to put Poppins...
Have you seen Aquaman yet?
Didn't see anything yet.
I've seen nothing. Poppins, Aquaman, Spider-Verse, Bumblebee.
Wow. Coy.
Spider-Verse, Poppins, Aquaman, Bumblebee.
Okay. Macuse?
I'm going to echo Riley.
Same thing. All right, I'm gonna say.
Are you guys trying to kill me?
Yeah.
No, here's the thing. I think you're right with the trailer. These most recent trailers, both of you, three of you, four, whatever. I liked all the stuff until I see the underwater video game, and then I am totally off the movie.
I'm afraid of third act Black Panther.
Yeah. Oh, here's what the thing. Black Panther. See, I would go more Wonder Woman. I think the Wonder Woman ending wasn't great for me, but I love that movie.
No, it wasn't. But we already established the second act doesn't matter, so we're in trouble.
Well, here we go. So the four for me, again, I think that all four of these movies are going to be good.
Yeah.
I think from best to worst, Mary Poppins, Bumblebee, Spider-Man, Aquaman.
Jason Aquaman.
Are you guys... So three of you in this room put Aquaman last.
Yeah. It's not that we think it's going to be bad.
I didn't say that you said that.
I think... I think there's going to be... It's you're going to walk out of that one... I don't know. That it's just... 5 months ago, I would have told you Bumblebee would be dead last.
Yeah.
I wouldn't even put it in the... I would say I refuse. But after seeing those trailers and seeing what Travis Knight has done and hearing his take on it and the fact that he had Stan Bush come out and sing at Comic-Con was amazing.
I'm over, you guys.
I think it's a battle of A's and A minuses. I think it's all – these are all going to be great. It's just the hierarchy. There's an incredible problem.
Yeah, that's the question.
I trust my lawyer, Jason Aquaman, more than I do.
Chum-a-ray!
Hey, everybody.
everybody.
All right, what's anything else coming out though besides those four? Those are like the four big ones. And then you got
Vice,
you
ask man. This.
Vice. Yeah. I'm excited for Vice.
On the 14th, when Spider-Verse comes out, we also have The Mule, which is, you know, going to be totally different.
Clint Eastwood, right?
But a big budget stuff with a name behind it, Mortal Engines.
Oh, yeah.
That's a Peter Jackson movie.
Stop.
Exactly. Yeah. I think this is going to get crushed.
There's no buzz
just
on this.
Nobody's going to see this.
I just saw the first trailer for it yesterday.
I'm excited to see this movie. I think that
on TV at least.
No, it's Peter Jackson, and I want to see what he's
producing
gonna do.
And writing.
Producing and writing. Yeah. I think that he is going to surprise us, and I think this movie will wind up being a surprise, and I think people will wind up like.
Who's directing it?
I don't
Jackson.
Know. No, he's not directing it.
Oh, he just wrote it.
Even if you're correct, and it's good critic wise, word of mouth starts spreading.
Yeah.
I think because it's so stacked, it's not
gonna
do well.
It's got a long way to go. I mean, look, the other thing is, so look at the movies that came out too over the weekend, right? Take me and Roxy out of the equation here. Widows has an amazing word of mouth.
What are people seeing?
But even so, let's take us out.
I know.
94% of people who saw that movie like loved it.
That's their score on Rotten Tomatoes.
Rotten Tomatoes
right
only 94%.
That's the critic score.
Critic score. But then people who are seeing it, fans are loving it, right? Again, take us out of the equation.
I'm not saying...
And the point is that movie did not do well. It did like $10 million.
Right.
Really?
Cost like $50 million or whatever it did, and it did not do well. So. And the reason I bring that up, but Mortal Engines, the same thing with all the competition that's coming out. Mm-hmm. Even if it's great, it's gonna be really climbing up a steep hill.
The hard part for me with Mortal Engines is watching that trailer because again, it just came on TV yesterday and I was like, I haven't even heard of this movie. Right? It looks like James and the Giant Peach meets Mad Max Fury Road. Mm-hmm. It's
cool.
Like that
that's
weird.
Yeah, that's incredible. Yeah.
But that. To me, I was like, okay, that for me, that looks pretty awesome.
But
right?
Who's the market?
But who's the market on that?
I always give a shot to those movies. Or two. When I see Peter Jackson's name, first thing is I go, all right, well, let's see.
You got to pay respect to that.
You got to pay respect to it. He's the producer of the movie, and it's also, what did he see in it?
Right. Popular book series. Super popular book series.
So yeah, he's maybe also, that.
He
What's it about?
All the world has become
water world
movable
thing, right?
Cities.
Yeah.
And so all the cities are on wheels and the cities battle each other. So like London is a main enemy of these other cities.
What's the James and the Giant Peach part?
Oh, the anime, like the actual CGI looks very darkish, like box trollish kind of a thing.
I'm just very curious about the movie. Like
me too.
I don't want to just discount it because you know, it's hard to market it right now because of all the other stuff. People, I mean, again, the first thing we're talking about are these four movies.
Right.
And we didn't even bring that up. And Riley's like, hey, by the way, this is coming out.
Yeah.
That's a problem.
Yeah. Like, well, truthfully, Kristian, you're doing your job. And that's you saying you don't want to discount it. You're doing your job.
Yeah.
But most people, it's not their job to be like, oh, but I want to give it a fair shake. Like, if they're not hearing about it, they're not seeing it.
That's right. You're right. It's like there's Peter Jackson holds a lot of weight, but how much weight? Right.
Mortal Engines is also a cool title that somebody may think is like, oh, what's this Oscar movie that Daniel Day-Lewis
is
in.
Yeah.
Right?
The lack of advertising is concerning. The studio doesn't trust it. Like, the fact that it's that close out, and we have these giant clusters of movies, and we haven't seen a lot of pushes in visual ads or trailers or anything like that, and, like, it's Oscar season right after this push, so when is that opportunity?
Yeah, I mean, I'm hoping it's soon, like, because I have high hopes for it, and I got my fingers crossed for Mortal Engines. I hope it's going to be good. What else is coming out?
Vice is my big one of the rest of the year.
Me too. Right. I'm so excited for it.
People are already saying that Christian Bale has a chance to get nominated.
And Amy
Adams.
And
Sam Rockwell is George Bush is inspired. Like, no one's talking about Sam Rockwell, but, like, I think he's George Bush. He's done.
Oh, he's invited.
That trailer, they looked, it was dead ringers.
Trailer
is freaky.
Phenomenal.
And I'm
phenomenal.
The man. That's where that is
on. Yeah. Who's talking in there?
Alex.
Hey,
I saw this a few months ago.
Vice.
Yes. And it, I don't know how much I can say, but it's going to get nominated for a lot of things.
Okay.
Alex,
okay.
How do you do all of the seeing things way earlier than any of us?
He goes to fan screenings.
Oh.
Right?
I got flagged on the Spider-Verse one. They caught me.
I told you
guys can't do that stuff.
I got flagged for one, too.
I was in line. They're like, no.
No.
Well, back in the day before they started.
Host of Heroes, can you please get out of line here?
I was in a Spider-Man line. Like,
yeah.
Well, back in the day, people used to do that stuff all the time. Before YouTube critics were getting invited to screenings, they would go to these fan screenings and put up their reviews early. And then
JT Wonder Woman.
Well, but JT was going to press screenings and doing it. And
moron.
Yeah.
But for Wonder Woman, he did the fan screening. I'm pretty sure he did that. And because he got
because
in
he
early.
Was associated with
but he was associated with
junkies.
Us and he
did that's what happened. Yeah, he went really early, saw something and he posted a review. What are you going to do?
Yeah.
I don't post I like that's the thing. You don't post a review. You wait till embargo. You respect the system.
That embargo was clearer. Like, I wish I could Google embargo on movies and know when they were.
Like, on the Google line, there's the release date, embargo date.
Well, they do, though.
Sometimes they don't. And then I search on Rotten Tomatoes to see if other people have said. Right. And then sometimes there's like three reviews. And I'm like,
I always usually ask the publicist when I get there if I need to know about it. They'll let you know when it is. And if it's debuted at a festival, then there is no embargo.
Yeah.
We missed a fairly big movie this conversation. Wednesday the 12th, Once Upon a Deadpool. What do you think? Because we know it's Deadpool 2.
When initially, and we haven't gotten the full details on this thing yet. But
why aren't they plugging it?
I don't know.
They just kind of started.
Trailer.
No, plugging. About you know, the reason why they're doing this is because it's for charity, and that hasn't been made clear.
Why isn't that the start of every video that they're showing and top of every article? Right. Nobody knows that.
It should be.
It changes my whole opinion on it.
Because when I didn't know what it was, I was like, why are they doing this? Just to make money? What a money grab. And then when I hear, well, why it's a money grab, I said, absolutely, you should do this, and I understand why you're doing this. So because it's for charity, I hope it does very well. And any money that it makes, then we'll go to kids, and yes, please. So, but am I excited to see it? No, but I applaud them for doing it.
I think it's neutering a character that really we've already experienced the neutering of. We've sewn his mouth shut already. So I'm worried about the precedent it sets.
Yeah.
I've said this on Heroes before. I'm afraid if it does too well, then the Disney people that will own him soon will go, oh, look, a PG-13 movie did well. So I'm afraid of that, like, long term, what it could mean for Deadpool. But as far as the what it's for, I want it to kill. And I love the fact that it's going to cross $2 billion. Like, with this movie, that's a huge franchise of two movies. Yeah. It's incredible.
Yeah,
it's
funny. Are you going to go?
I'll be there. I'll be there open at night. Like, especially since I know what it's for. Like cancer research is so tied to the character that it's not even important. It's so intrinsic to Deadpool. So I love that they're doing it. And Ryan Reynolds putting his foot down on that is great.
Yeah. All right. Well, I think that what time is it right now? We have
11:25.
11:25. So Coy, I wanted to thank you for coming in.
Absolutely.
It's a pleasure to have you back in. Make sure you check out Coy. Give me a shout. Let them know where they can find Heroes. Obviously, on the podcast feed, but on YouTube.
Yeah, we're on Wednesdays at 2:00, Collider Heroes. And on my Twitter and Instagram, I review all the other stuff I can't talk about on Heroes, like Vice and Vox Lux, I think looks great, too.
Oh, cool.
Natalie Portman movie where she played the diva.
Yep.
Mm. Yeah. I'm not hearing much about that either.
This year is so weird because it's clusters and then silence. Yeah. Like, it's this roller coaster of movies, nothing.
Boom. Natalie Portman is a diva? Surely you just.
What do I mean about that? But yeah,
did you know she dated Moby?
What?
So the strangest thing, I was on my way in today. I was on my way with Brett when we were listening, and I was going through. This is the one thing, like I said, I can't check my phone when I'm driving by myself, but I'm with Brett and checking my phone. And one of those articles, the strangest celebrity couples to ever date.
Right? I click on every single one of them.
Every time, all of them, every single
Roger
time.
Roger Ebert and Oprah Winfrey went on a few dates.
I did know that. Wow. That's crazy. Hysterical.
But Moby and Natalie Portman, it was very bizarre.
For a long time?
I don't think for very long, but you know, just that they were linked together for a little bit was pretty interesting. There were some really interesting ones on there for sure.
Wow.
Yeah.
But and anyway. Also, welcome to Marwin, Robert Zemeckis. That's this year.
Steve Carell.
Yeah, that looks really
anything
good.
Anything Zemeckis, I'm there.
Have you guys ever seen the Brad Pitt looks like his girlfriend anytime he dates somebody?
No.
You have to check out this article.
So we'll get to talk about these in depth. Good. Maybe we'll talk about it tomorrow. But that's what we're going to talk about when we get back. The director of Creed 2, Steven Caple Jr., is live in studio, and he will be here at 11:30. I am so excited to speak to him. I know that Roxy and Josh are as well. So after the break, Creed 2, Steven Caple Jr. Hello, Collider fans. I'm Kristian Harloff, and you see my stupid name in the background because that's my other show. It's One-on-One with me, Kristian Harloff. What the hell is it? I just sit down and talk to people. I literally just sit down and talk to people about what the hell's going on in their lives and their careers, and it's a long-form interview show. Originally, it aired on Collider Video as far as the YouTube channel goes, but we moved it on over, and it's on the Collider Podcast, on YouTube. Go on over there if you want to see the video and to see the pretty faces that I'm talking to. Had some great guests over the past. And we're going to have a lot more. And there's going to be people that you, maybe some celebrities or actors and actresses, producers, writers, all that stuff. But there's also a lot of the people that you know around here. I could have Cobbster on there. I could have Jeff Snyder, John Rocha, Mark Reilly, Roxy Striar, whoever. And I'm going to find out more about them. Long form, and also go to Apple Podcasts and check out the One-on-One feed with Kristian Harloff. And not only is my show on there, Mark Reilly, the
Reilly Roundtable, which is another sit-down, long-form interview show. That's also there. And when Steve Frosty Weintraub talks to Kevin Smith or George Takei, that's going to be on that podcast feed also. So if you're taking a long drive and you like those long-form interviews, pop on the one-on-one with Kristian Harloff. Give it a rate, comment, do all that because it helps the show and it makes Podcast One go, hey, you know what? Those people should get ad money.
Oh, hi, guys. It's Perry here, and I am going to tell you about The Witching Hour. It is the show that I host along with Collider.com's Haley Fouch. It is in podcast form on the Collider Factory feed, and we also have the video up and running every Tuesday for you right there on the Collider Podcast YouTube channel. We talk about everything horror. We're talking TV, movies, the newest releases. We talk about movies that are celebrating anniversaries. We've even talked about books. It's crazy. If it is scary, we are talking about it on The Witching Hour. We also have so many filmmaker interviews, really cool stuff. It's all coming your way every single Tuesday on The Witching Hour. Check it out. Collider Factory and the Collider Podcast YouTube channel.
Hello, Collider Live. My name is Amy Dallin.
And I'm Coy Jandreau, and we host a little show we love called Collider Heroes. And it is all of the things we love about movies, TV, comics themselves, all the breaking news, trailers, photos, but not paparazzi photos.
All of the superhero stuff we love, all of the indie comic stuff we love, all the stuff you had no idea was based on comics.
80 years of comic lore have led to this show and many years in film and TV, and we're living in a golden age of comics, and we want to share all of that zeal with you folks.
So we talk about the stuff that's coming out. We talk about what we hope is coming out. We do fantasy casting of things that should exist. Why don't they exist?
And we do your Twitter questions asking directly to us what we think of certain things. And every single week, since we both actually love and read physical comics by in print, we have a comic pull list where our five biggest favorite books of the week come out, and we dive into those with you guys.
You can buy digital. I'll forgive you. As long as you're paying for your comics, it's all good.
But if you buy in print, you can bag them and board them, and then they're worth more later, because comics are like certain things from the 90s that are totally worth the value. Buy comics. Buy in print. Digital's never worth anything later. Buy in print. Keep comic stores alive.
Or we can debate collector's items all day long. We can debate casting. We can debate movie news. We can have all of our friends come join us, as we frequently do. We can ask professionals about their work. We've had some amazing guests come by the show.
Yep.
We try to catch it every Wednesday.
That are on these properties that also love comics. You hear what it's like from their perspective, from inside, from outside. And this is all with the focus of bringing all this news to you guys. And we're here every Wednesday on Collider. And we love this stuff and want to share it with you guys.
We'll see you then.
Hey guys, Reilly here, and let me tell you about the Reilly Roundtable. That's right, they gave Reilly his own podcast. The Reilly Roundtable is on its new home, and that is one-on-one with Kristian Harloff on the iTunes feed for Podcast One. It drops every Thursday. The Reilly Roundtable is a little bit about everything. It's about movies and life and movies and everything in between. I like to have on special guests for discussions like Justice League versus Batman v Superman, for discussions about wine tasting, for discussions about UFOs, and everything in between. That's right. The Reilly Roundtable drops on Thursdays on the one-on-one with Kristian Harloff podcast feed and later on Collider Video's own podcast video network. So check it out every Thursday, the Reilly Roundtable. See you there.
Hey everyone, this is John Rocha. You know me as one of the co-hosts for Collider Sports Time every Monday on Collider Sports YouTube and podcast channel. But we got another show on here. That's Collider Sportsbook. Josh Macuga, the Wild Man, he hosts that one. I join him on those, and they're a lot of fun. We break down the lines and the predictions with the over and unders. A lot of stuff going on for all the NFL games and some select college football games as well. We do that every week. We also do special ones on Thursday nights for those Thursday night football games. Let you know where to put your money, what bets to put down, who to go with, who not to go with. We give you a lot of information and we give you our thoughts. You know, Josh Macuga, he does it by the gut. I do it more from the statistics point of view. And every once in a while, Mark Fernandez even joins us to throw in his two cents on the Thursday night sports book. So there's a lot of sports action here on Sports Time on the Collider Sports YouTube and podcast channel. Join us there. Subscribe there. Definitely on the podcast channel. We need your downloads, subscriptions, and views there. So give us some love on Collider Sports, and we'll talk to you soon.
And we are back, ladies and gentlemen, in just a second. Creed 2 director himself, Steven Caple Jr., will be live in studio talking about Creed. He just arrived, and we're excited to get him in here to talk about it.
Because of, you know, obviously
everything,
the Rocky fandom that we have here, and I want to know his experience. I want to learn about this. Because remember, Ryan Coogler really blew up from this movie, and then went on to do Black Panther, and then there was the talk about him doing the movie, and then he didn't do it. So how, I want the just the progression of how he became the director of it to be interesting. But I do want to make a very special announcement here.
Oh,
I got the okay that I can do this.
Really?
Schmodown.
Oh no!
Live.
It's over.
Nope. Schmodown live. We were talking about where we're going to do it.
Yeah.
We officially can announce it. January 26th.
Whoa.
We are coming to New York, baby. Whoa. January 26th, New York.
New York City.
Post it in the Schmodown groups. Post it everywhere you can. The Schmodown will be there. Full screen live. Schmodownlive.com. Presented by Full Screen. Schmodownlive.com. And the main event will be for the singles championship. Whoever the singles champion is, either John Rocha or the winner of the tournament, whoever wins that is going to play John Rocha at Spectacular, and then the number one contender will play for the championship January 26th. The singles championship will be on the line in a TBD. I asked all these people. I said, New York, Chicago, who wanted us to go? And over 2,500 people had voted, come to New York, real quick. So prove that you really want it. Sell us out quick. Yeah. How many people from New York?
It's a Saturday or it's a Friday?
It's a Saturday night. In Brooklyn.
Whoa.
It's in Brooklyn, January 26th.
Where Brooklyn at?
So January 26th, we're going home. I'm going
Josh
home.
Josh and I are both going to be there, too.
So we're going to have, it is January 26th, and you can get it. Again, New York, you asked for it. Show us, schmodownlive.com, because I don't know when we're going back. We're going once. So if you want to come see us, get the tickets now, schmodownlive.com.
That's a huge deal.
That's big.
Are you happy that New York won?
Chicago was pretty close, and to be honest with you, I'm working on Chicago also, but New York was the one that we were really putting together. We've had it locked down for a little bit. We just wanted to get the venue.
Is Chicago the one that's maybe coincide with Star Wars Celebration?
We're working on it. And there's another thing. I'm going to be able. So at the end of Schmodown Spectacular, I have a very big announcement of how next season in general is going to run.
Gotcha.
And the live events play into that pretty
Wild
big.
Wildberries is in every match.
Wildberries is going to have a big part to do with a lot of stuff for sure. I'm working on a Wildberries animation series.
Yeah.
So that's to be something that'd be interesting.
Is that true?
Yeah, that is actually very true. But there's things that I want a lot of things that we're working on. But the big thing I want to see today, New York has been asking for it every single time I ask for where should we go.
Are you
going to
put the tickets? Like, is the link going to be live?
They're already live. It's live right now. Schmodownlive.com. If they go there, because I want to see if New York, because everyone's telling me you got to come to New York. I'll get a ticket immediately. If you go to New York, I'll go.
Bunch of liars.
I want to see
how many seats we have.
Because there's close to 400. So the other thing that I was.
Well, do you know the name of the auditorium?
I have it. I don't know if I have it here yet. I can tell you. No, I don't have it yet. But
it's called Big Apple.
But they have it in the when you buy the tickets, schmodownlive.com. And the thing is that I know from being in New York, it's always New York versus LA, Dodgers and Yankees back in the day, right? So LA took about a month and a half, 2 months to sell out. I want to see how fast New York can sell us out.
What do you think?
I think New York can do it in 2 to 3 weeks. I think New York can sell us out in 2 to 3 weeks. Because again, LA knew that they were probably going to have another show. I don't know, if nobody comes to the show, then we're not going to be going back to New York.
You think
but I
people
doubt
are going
to
come from Connecticut, from Philly,
Boston. I think Philadelphia people will come in. I think that I don't know the next time we're going to the East Coast. So
it's
called
the Roulette Intermedium.
Well, how do you know that?
Because you just looked it up.
Oh, because you just looked it up. Okay,
what
so
do you
there
mean,
we
how
go.
Does he know it? What did you think he was doing?
I had no idea, but he figured it out.
You frustrated with me today?
No. No, no, no.
The singles title line on other matches.
Yeah.
Undercard match.
Yeah. It's going to be, and it's going to be good because.
Nice graphic, too.
Who's on the graphic?
Mark and Kristian.
Yeah. Right now we are because.
But they have shirts that say New York on it.
I can't put anybody on there yet because, again, Rocha will be playing the winner of this tournament that's going on at the Spectacular. Now, whoever the champion is at the very end will defend against the number one contender. And the number one contender will be decided at the Spectacular as well.
Oh, gotcha,
so whoever wins that number one contender match will be going to New York to face whoever the champion is.
Yeah.
So this tournament now really means a lot.
It's going to be cold.
Really means a lot. Yeah. Yes. Coming in now, director of Creed 2. We're very excited. Steven Caple Jr. is in the house, ladies and gentlemen. Nice to have you, man.
Thank you.
Steven Caple Jr. is here. Creed 2 is about to hit theaters. And what a whirlwind you must be going through right now.
It's trippy.
It's crazy, right?
Yeah, it's trippy. Is this an applaud going on?
Yeah. They're going
it's our live TV audience.
That's cool. Yeah. Oh, man, I love it.
Good. It's good to have you, man.
Yeah, it comes out tonight. Yeah. Really, people are going to check it out tonight, which is scary, man.
I'm sure it is. Well, the journey, we were just talking about before you got in there, the journey that you went through has got to be crazy and scary also, because, correct me if I'm wrong, what way it was, I loved Fruitvale Station when Cougar had done that movie that he already won me over. Then when I heard he was doing Creed, I got a chance to go to Philadelphia for the press thing. I talked to him. I talked to Michael B. Jordan, and I talked to Stallone. And it was one of these things. It blew my mind. I'm a hardcore Rocky fan. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm a hardcore fan. So then, and he blew me away with that film. And everyone was talking. He's going to do the second one. Then he goes on to do Black Panther.
Yeah.
Then it's Stallone's going to do the second one, right?
Yeah.
And then they say Steven Caple Jr. is doing it. And the first thing is
out of nowhere. It was nowhere. What the? Who is this guy? He just rolled up.
Tell me about that. Yep. How did that go down?
No, I mean I knew Ryan before Fruitvale. You know what I mean? Like, we went to USC together.
Fight on, me too.
You fight on USC? Hey.
Please beat Notre Dame this weekend. Just
beat him. Be somebody. So we met during film school. You know what I mean? And he's always been kind of like a big bro and mentor, you know. And so when he did, you know, Fruitvale and Creed, I did not have any intention on doing Creed 2. I don't think he did either, actually. You know, when he was talking about it, he was like, you know, I was just a one-off, man. They're like, I wanted to get the story out, something he was passionate about. So long story short, when Sly was going to write and direct it, which he did write, he wrote a draft of it. I got called in like immediately afterwards, like, dude, we need that voice of the generation. Sly felt like he found the format and this, that, and the other. Really, he also wants to shoot Rambo. So
Yeah.
What you shooting right now?
Yeah, no, which looks amazing.
He's insane.
Rambo
on
a horse, I'm in.
Yeah. Rambo on a horse in the outfit, he's definitely in, man. He's doing all kind of stuff. I saw some really dope photos they sent me earlier, too, of the set. But yeah, long story short, I got a call randomly out of nowhere. You know what I mean? Ryan didn't even tell me. It was like the studio was like, hey,
oh wow,
we want to make this movie, and we saw your first feature to land, and we think you have this voice. Mike saw it. Sly saw it. They want to meet you. And I was like, man, I called Ryan like, dude, you ain't even tell me this.
So Ryan put your name up to them?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yep. Wow.
I was like, bro, you didn't even tell me this. Yeah. Nah, completely. You know? And then next thing you know, I was in a room with Sly. I was skeptical, too. I was like, I wasn't sure about doing it because it was a sequel. The Dragos were coming back. Love what they did in 86 with the Dragos. Right. But I was like, bringing them back is kind of scary because the first one was like, it felt grounded. You know what I mean?
You don't want it to be cheesy.
Exactly. That was like a huge concern of mine. I was like, and it's a sequel and coming off of Ryan, who's like killing the game.
Right.
You're like, dude, I got my own like little voice and style, and I don't want to be... You know what I mean? It's a transition, and you don't want to drop the ball, basically.
Right. And you also want to be like, okay, well, he did what he did, and so I have to mimic his stuff.
I have to do the same thing. Right. And that was my concern. And then I met Sly, and he was like, nah, man, you should definitely just put your own stamp on it. And same with Ryan. He was like, dude, his exact words, the movie's not going to be good unless you're putting your thing on it. So that made me feel comfortable. And MGM was like, do it.
What were you working on at this, like, while you were kind of interviewing?
No, I was working on two different things. So after the first feature, I got this HBO miniseries, Emmett Till, started. And I just ran in on that. I was like, I don't want to do anything else. You know what I mean? Like, I want to get Emmett Till off the ground. It's a story I felt like needed to be told. And for some reason, no one wants to do a movie on it, or a TV show, or a miniseries.
They're not going to do it.
They're not going to do it.
Really?
They're not going to do it. So I spent a year writing the series.
Let's see how much money this movie makes.
So with that, I spent the year on that, and I was writing this other piece on the first African-American NASCAR driver, twisted story about Wendell Scott. I thought it was just a cool story. It's like an amazing journey with him and his two sons and Jim Crow South. So
as a guy who knows NASCAR, it's a cool story.
It's an insane freaking story. Super light-skinned dude. Sometimes he was past as white to like getting into races. Moonshine runner. I mean, his two boys were on a road. I could go deep into it, but I was going to Virginia visiting him, going through the routes with the family. The two boys who were kids at the time,
right.
Two sons, you know, the dark stories of like how they would be on the road and running into situations.
So your mind was locked completely into something else.
The only time I was directing was when it was something short because I wanted to just flex muscle and you know what I mean? Like it's like shooting around. So I did a docu-series. Did a documentary on this rapper named Logic.
Okay.
And that was really cool because he has a really unique story as well. And I was like, I'll do it. You know what I mean? It takes a few weeks and doesn't need to be rushed. And then I did a TV show called Grownish by Kenya Bears, who did Blackish. And he's just family, like, to all of us. Like, he's like, you know, one of the guys who are doing it and putting young black directors on. And so was like, why not? It's 2 weeks. Sure. I was like, I'll do that and still write. I didn't want to do any other features. And then Creed 2 came out.
This land, man, because were you a big, I mean, I'm sure that you've gotten this question a billion times throughout this thing, but it's, I think it's, you have to be asked, how big of a Rocky fan were you in general?
Big. I mean, I don't know who wasn't. That's why I keep saying, like, when people say, how big a Rocky fan, I was like, is that a thing? Like, no one likes, who doesn't like Rocky? or who hasn't seen it?
There's someone out in our office that hasn't seen it yet, and I'm going to, Dorian.
He said he just saw all of them yesterday, I believe.
Did Dorian watch?
Yeah, shorter guy.
No. That's Coy. Dorian is the tall black dude.
The black kid. That was in. Oh, yeah, he didn't say anything about it. Maybe that's what he's
a little sheepish. You don't want to admit it.
Bring him in. We gotta talk about this. Completely, man. It's weird because I keep, everyone's like, what's the first Rocky you've seen? It was Rocky 5, apparently, which is like the worst one. But
it was George Washington Duke.
I know, it wasn't when I was like 5, though. I thought Tommy Gunn and the whole story was amazing. I was like, this is dope.
That's true. I guess that's like watching like the first Star Wars, you know, episode 1 as a kid. It's a very different movie. But going, because you are trusted. See, this is a little daunting if I think about it, because you're now trusted. Where Coogler, he comes in and he was handed all the stuff that came before him, but he gets to really create inside of this new
Creed world.
Now you
10 years later,
you're taking over two different franchises. You're taking over the Rocky franchise and you're taking over the Creed franchise here too, and being able to work with both of these guys. Now Michael B. Jordan, who has really cemented himself as Adonis Creed, and you got Balboa there, so. Do you get intimidated at all? Or you can't. You just have to go in there and move.
I describe it as like when you're sprinting on the treadmill or running on the treadmill, and you don't want to look down at the how long you've been going for, and you just keep going. You know what I mean? Because once you look down, you get tired, you get exhausted, you get afraid. You know what I mean? And I think this was that same situation. Once they told me out of these meetings I had with them, do your own thing. Hearing that from Sly, and then hearing that from Mike B, who's also a producer on this.
Yeah,
I felt good. You know what I mean? That made me feel better. And then approaching it, it was like, how do I do that? And then being a fan, I felt like if I was just true to myself, I'll be okay. Like, I'm a fan. I know what I want to see out of this series.
Right.
Like, just being someone who's into it, I'm like, I know how much to pull from Rocky IV, but also being a fan of Creed 1, I know we had that cheese meter on set. Like, we kept checking in with it. Like,
no robots.
Like,
no robots.
No, legit.
Up.
No cyborgs. No, none of that. But even with Adonis' storyline, he's coming off of Killmonger because he really goes in deep with his character. Yeah. So it's like, make sure everyone was reconnected with who they were. And because I just made sure that they were the same person in Creed 1 that everyone loved, and that there was homage and nostalgia and the heart from the other Rocky franchise series that we loved that was incorporated in it. So it was a balance. And then whenever I had an opportunity, I was like, that moment's going to be me. I'm going to add my flair here, there, to where it's not like destroying the franchise. You know what I mean? And I don't think it will destroy the franchise, but I didn't want to hurt or pull away from things that I just love. Yeah. So when you watch the movie tonight, I feel like you're going to get a bit of both of that, you know, with Tessa.
Good, Kristian and I watched it, and it's bomb.
Thank you.
It's
thank
unbelievable.
You just kept this secret from me the whole time. I already.
I finally realized you didn't know that we'd seen it.
So. We both saw it, because I'm going to set you up for this, because the thing is, too, I saw it, we talked about it today, I saw it in a small MGM screening room with like 12, 13 people where you could still, and I saw it with John Rocco, who's equally as big of a Rocky fan as I am, and we were just kind of like together, felt like we were watching a fight on pay-per-view, right?
Yeah.
Roxy made me jealous because last night she said she saw it in a full packed theater, and people were screaming and yelling and cheering.
Like it was a sporting event. It was at the Grove. It was the press screening.
Oh, yeah, I heard about
that. I've never seen, the press screening started over 30 minutes late because there was a mob of people. I've never seen that happen before. Yeah. Like fans waiting to get into the press screening when they weren't supposed to be there. So people were like dying over this. And then people were shouting, I can't say what because it will give away parts of the movies at the screen, but like encouraging different people to do different moves. Screaming
it's
out
insane.
Loud. Like, it was
I'm going to Crenshaw. I'm going to go to watch it. You have to watch it. Like, my premiere was the first. Now, you go to test previews and you test the film. It's so hard because there's a lot of emotional moments in the film as well.
Yeah.
So I'm like, damn, are people being engaged? Like, what's going on? And then there's a moment where you have a small clap, but I don't think people know they can just let go.
With the explosion. You can
explode.
Yeah.
The premiere, we had a mixture of us, but we had four theaters were packed out, and we also had just real people, like just guests, all kinds of stuff. Like just, and then that was my first time experiencing the way
That's
you
amazing.
Did. Where like, oh, people are clapping here. Oh, people think he's about to walk out there. This, that. And I'm like, oh, this is trippy because like now I get to actually feel what the audience is feeling.
I'd like to point out though that the only thing I've asked for all year on this show is an invite to one of the screenings. It's all I wanted.
This was his Star Wars.
Cold-blooded. I wasn't involved in that. I didn't even know they saw the film.
Dude, I grew up in Pennsylvania, man. Rocky is he's our
man.
Person.
What part?
I grew up in Pittsburgh.
Okay.
But
rivalries. I'm from Cleveland.
Okay. Oh, shit. Oh, man. Because you did the land.
I did. Yes.
And I spent a lot of people from my hometown have migrated towards Cleveland for work or whatever. Mm-hmm. But, you know, I have a lot of family in Philadelphia. All the Italians either were in Pittsburgh or in Philadelphia. Uh-huh. And so when you go, hearing stories from my buddies that live in Philly, like Steve Simone, Christian, when Rocky III came out and Survivor came out with that song, and then when Rocky IV came out, so I call my buddies in Philly, and they're like, dude, this is our holiday weekend. Creed comes out, the entire city of Philadelphia is like getting the day off school tomorrow to go see Creed
II. That's crazy.
The Eagles can win the Super Bowl, all that kind of stuff. Rocky is still their superhero.
He is, man. Yeah. Rocky's a legend, bro. He's a legend, man. Like, I learned so much from him on set. You know what I mean? Like, it was trippy because the first time I always tell the story, I won't try to make it not boring. The first time I met him, I was like, it was intimidating. You know what I mean? It's like, I was like, this dude is like a hero. You know what I mean? Like, he's done so many great movies. I'm like, I'm trying to remember a movie I haven't seen. I was like, literally, while I'm walking up to his door, it just kept all the movies popping in my head. I'm like, Demolition Man.
I was just going to say Demolition Man.
Cliffhanger. It's like, oh, we're here, Judge Dredd. I was like, all here. And then when I met him, it was like, he is such a cool guy. Like, he's so, like, he's an artist, dude.
Yeah.
Like, I always saw him as, like, a superstar.
Yeah.
But he's really an artist, man. Like, he is so smart. If you guys ever get the chance to meet him or have a conversation with him.
I did, and he's unbelievable.
Yeah. He's, like, intelligent, like, because he plays Rocky so well that you think that that's him.
He's just locked into it.
Like, he gets into character. I just posted a photo on Instagram of a behind the scenes from my personal phone of him getting into character. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. It was just like him, just like he zones out. He puts his hat on and walks around with the ball, and it's so cool. Like, if you're a fan, you're just like, this dude's about
That's to on your Instagram?
Yeah, I just posted literally while I was in the bathroom walking this way. All I got right. lost.
Does the studio get upset when you post things like that?
Probably, but it's the day we just released. So, and I wanted to, because they're giving out all these photos that they've taken.
Yeah.
And I'm like, man, I took some really cool photos because I was in the space. You know what I mean? And it was moments where, as a fan, I was like, this is surreal.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, there was a moment where, you know, today I posted to Tessa and Mike going through their lines inside the ring.
Yeah.
And, like, I was just there waiting for the camera setup, and I just took it on my phone because, like, oh, this is intimate. I'm going to keep it for my own personal thing. And then same with Sly. Sly does it a lot. He's always on his phone. And, you know, he was just there bouncing his ball, and I keep telling this story. And then I looked at my phone today, and I'm like, I forgot I took this photo of him bouncing the ball and leaning and getting it to character.
That's awesome.
I'm like, I'm going to post it for the fans. That's hopefully really cool. They dig it. You know?
Well, you know what was cool about that whole thing?
MGM.
Check that out, because I'm going to be checking out. So what you were saying about how the studio and Sly and Mike were like, you know, do your thing. We want your voice on it. Now, you hear a lot. I mean, obviously, it seems like that was what happened here. And from what we saw on screen, it certainly seems like that, too.
Yeah.
Because what I thought was cool, there's two things I want to bring in here, too. The first is that, so I'm a big Star Wars fan as well.
Okay.
I like what J.J. Abrams did in The Force Awakens because I thought it was an homage to the stuff that we had seen before. And there's some familiar moments, but then he made a lot of the story beats with new characters and things, too.
Yeah.
There was certainly a lot of that in the script that Sly wrote, to where you could throw back to Rocky III, you could throw back to Rocky II, you'd certainly throw back to Rocky IV. There's even a little bit of Rocky V in there too. So there's things inside of that that you were able to do and make it your own. But did you ever get nervous that they were going to say, because if Sly comes over and goes, well, I don't like that choice. What if you do this instead? I'm sure that there's suggestions, but I always think of Gavin Hood in X-Men when that happened.
I mean, we have to. That's the open dialogue. That's the honesty on set.
Yeah.
You know I mean, that's why, you know, if they were calling me back to do another one, I would do it just because that was the set. It was like, dude, you did this for 40-plus years. So if I'm doing something and you're like, yo, and that's how Sly approaches you, like, this you might want to try, this, that, and the other, I would be like, cool, let me try it. Most of the time, it's like the right move. You know,
right.
Or there was a lot of times where I went up to him and like, dude, I'm rushing behind Day. I don't know how to make Day. Like, just give me advice on how to shoot a fight scene from the distance and hurry up and get through. Those were moments where we collaborated. Beyond that, I mean, he knew the character. For me, it was just guiding him, if that makes sense.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? So it was like, I want you to go to here to there, get a feel for it, or you know, he was trying to tell a joke, and I was there to help it make it more modern, so to speak. Like, you know what I mean? Like, there's some things out now that just wouldn't work during that time period, but will work right now if you say this name or
you
work
were Adonis
this way.
And he was on.
Yeah, exactly, completely, yeah. And that's how he. I mean, that's why he brought me onto the project.
Yeah,
you know, it was Sly who was like, this dude got it. He's a fan, and I think he'll definitely be able to speak to. Like, that's why I was hired. You know what I mean? So it was none of that really. I mean, it was definitely times. I mean, he's the guru of the fight stuff, man. Really, that's what he really cares about. You know what I mean? It's like, make sure there's a story within the fight, that there's art, and that you keep certain rules alive. Like, he's not the one who's saying you got to fit a Bill Conti Rocky theme in there.
Right.
It's me in the studio. Like, us fans are like, we know they want to hear that somewhere. So where do we place it?
He just wants you to tell a story inside the ring.
Completely.
Because a lot of boxing movies miss that. And I think a lot of boxing movies that you see trailers for, you're like, okay. But then you get in and it seems very cookie cutter. Like, maybe the most recent one that didn't do that was The Fighter, the one with Mark Wahlberg.
It wasn't even about boxing.
No. But when you got in the ring in that final fight and it was head body, it told that story and wrapped that whole thing up.
Exactly.
Yeah, I think it's tough.
And that's what we were trying to do, is just make sure, like, if I took the boxing out, was there a story there? You know what I mean? Like, does it feel like a film? And, and I think with all the drama we added, and you know, it gets a little dark, obviously, a bit, which hasn't really in the past, that was the fresh approach. That was the way to be like, all right, there is a story and heart here. And that wasn't there before. That's what Sly brought me in for.
Here's what I think you did in this movie. And I think that I know that, I don't know if you do share this yet, but I know John Rocha does. I think that what you successfully did in this movie is you transitioned this away from, because I think the first movie was certainly about Creed, but Rocky had a big part to do with it, with the whole, I think that this is a Creed movie. I think this has turned this into, Rocky is Mickey now. Rocky is officially Mickey, and this is a Creed film, and I think that you did it successfully. I think I want to see a third one, I hope that that's something you're interested in down the line if they decide to do it. I do have a question.
If they bring me back. You know what I'm saying?
Well, I have a
no more set photos!
This weekend, guys. This weekend.
I have a feeling they will.
Photos.
Right. That's it. You just lost the gig on your Instagram. But what I wanted to ask you about, because maybe I missed this in the first Creed.
Oh.
I thought Rocky and his son were good by Rocky Balboa.
Did they mention it briefly? Right? I was because that's what caught my attention in Creed 1. I was like, when he had cancer and everything, I was like, where's Robert? Like, you know, where's Milo? There's a moment where they move into the house. They moved into he moved Adonis into the house, and he's like, who's this? You know, he's like, this is Paulie's old room. What about your son? He's like, he moved away. He couldn't handle the pressures of blah, blah, being under his shadow, basically, saying that there's tension there.
Okay.
And so when Sly wrote the draft, he wrote it in a way that was basically true to his life. Like, all these moments are like, even with, like, it's like finding out, like, where is he at in his actual life? And how he needs to reconnect with certain people at because now he does feel like he's at a certain age, and there's things that you contemplate when you're at that age in your life.
Yep.
And this is one of the gaps, but he doesn't know how to. It's actually like, it's very similar to my father, actually. He doesn't know how to approach it. You know what I mean? Like, he feels like he's failed, you know? And so that's sort of like his arc through this, but they weren't in touch. Yeah. You know what I mean? And that's what I wanted to know. And I figured it was the case because he didn't pop up when he had cancer. There was no phone call to Robert. There was nothing. I was just like, dang, so Robert just didn't show up.
Right.
But the secret was he was trying to keep the cancer thing under wraps throughout Creed 1 and not tell anyone.
Didn't want to burden him with it.
Exactly. And wanted to let the kid do his fighting. So in Creed 2, it was like, I feel like maybe we should knock on that door and see what's going on.
Yeah. And I'm glad you just, if you don't mind, so you said you, with your dad, you said you relate to that then?
Yeah, no, completely, man. I just got, because subconsciously, I didn't know that I did it on purpose in the Drago side of the family, because my dad was very like, you know, you got to be an athlete, you got to be a basketball player, putting pressure on me, putting pressure on my sister. And I didn't do it. I became a freaking artist, I guess.
Yeah.
And so there was that, and there is this rekindling of the relationship that's actually going on right now. But it wasn't until the premiere that I don't want to get emotional now, but it wasn't until the premiere that I saw a piece of me in that scene with him and his son.
Yeah.
Like, when he's at the door, because my dad hasn't been around my life, like, you know what I mean? And then I never really caught his perspective. I always blamed him for it. You know what I mean? Like, dude, you ain't around, this, that, and the other.
Right.
And then at the premiere, honestly, and I'm not even trying to, like, I can't take this credit as a director. It just kind of happened. Seeing a movie in this certain scene without spoiling it popped up. I was like, wow, like, he really doesn't know what to say. You know what I'm saying? He really doesn't know what to do. That's why he's been sort of absent. And that's what my dad has been telling me throughout these years. But I was blocking it off because I was so angry at him for trying to push me a certain direction, this, that, and the other. And then now I would always get mad when he's like, not showing up at certain events or birthday or my wedding or whatever it is. I'm like upset, but not realizing he's ashamed. Yeah. You know what I mean? He doesn't know how to approach it. And then watching the film, Sly gave this performance, and it was my first time feeling in a theater. I was like, whoa, like I felt it. And I was like, I didn't know. And it made me think about my pops. And yeah. Then I went to Cleveland the next day to preview the film, and I just took him on tour with me the rest of the time just to.
You guys are kind of patching things up?
Yeah, we are patching things up.
So your dad saw the movie?
He saw the movie.
What do you
think
of it?
He went crazy, man. He's super proud. It was just an emotional time back at home, especially for him. So yeah, like, you know, just bringing it back to Cleveland, but on top of that, him just looking at his son make this film, and it's about fatherhood.
It is. I'm a father of two girls myself, and I was watching that movie, and what you did with both sides of here, because you know, Rocky serves as a father figure mm-hmm. to Adonis, but I was wondering, like you said, you want to try to get away from the cheese factor because that could mm-hmm. be dangerous. There's none of that with the Dragos. And I got to be honest, I think the Dragos stuff is some of the most fascinating stuff in the entire movie.
Man. Like, wow, that's the crazy stuff.
Oh, that kicked my ass because that was, I was wondering, Dolph Lundgren, I mean, when in 85 or 86, the movie, when it comes out, he's this like intimidating, crazy, stereotypical character.
Yeah.
But there's layers. Mm-hmm. There, and you really dive deep into those layers about what it's all about, what it meant. I mean, it's in the trailer to where after that fight with him and Rocky, things went wrong for him. The whole country turned the back on Drago, mm-hmm. and he's put that anger and stuff into his son.
Well, he lifted the politician out of the ring. Of course, he's going to turn him
crazy. Yeah, but so when you hear you tell that story now, it makes so much sense and how much you kind of relate it to.
No, definitely, completely, man. And then him pushing that into his son. You know what I mean? Like, you're the one who's about to go out there and make a name for us. Yeah. You know, and put us back. So that's where the revenge story slips away. Like, that's how me and Adolph and Florian looked at it. Like, we always talked about redemption. You know what I mean? It's totally two different things. Revenge, I'm going out to break him and kill him no matter what. And it means necessary. He's going to die, whatever cyborg robot thing he needs to say. Yeah. But in this case, it was like, nah, if I'm trying to get my name back out there to show my worth, it's different. You know what I mean? If I'm trying to show that I am somebody, but yet then they start to, obviously there's layers behind it, but it's very subtle. Like you said, like I didn't want it to be too on the nose and hard. Like there's a lot of this stuff is told through looks. It's told through small sentences here and there, and it's spread out throughout the film. So in the beginning, you don't know what you're supposed to feel about these dudes yet. And then as you kind of track through it, you're like, hopefully, again, you guys saw it. The world is about to see it tonight.
Right. Yeah.
That was the goal. was to feel that way. And Dolph was excited, bro. He trusted me.
I've met him before. You've got to move in to get into that.
You got to know some of the core emotional stuff. Him and Florian had to let me in their life, man, because he was going to a place where he's never gone before in films. He's always like, I'm this guy. I'm da 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 da.
Right.
The bad guy at the table, but not necessarily having like scenes where I get emotional and have reasoning behind some of the things I do. So. Yeah, man.
Do you think that Rocky IV was the reason for the end of communism?
If I could change, you could change.
Everybody could change. The movie is Creed 2. It opens tonight, ladies and gentlemen. Make sure you check that out. Steven Caple Jr., thank you for joining us here today. Congratulations.
Sure. Congratulations. Thank you. Yeah. Thanks so much.
Was there ever talk about Paulie's robot coming back into the movie?
Yes, it was completely. We had to head on set. We was trying to figure out where to place it at. They also did it in Creed, but it was in a deleted scene.
Oh, really?
And so they never made the movie. And then the production designer was like, he came through one day like, here's the head of the robot. And I was like, where can we put it? And I'm like, man, it may be too much. We got the Dragos back. And at a certain point, I was trying to bring everything back.
That's so good. Happy birthday, Paulie. All right, well, guys, thank you for watching. Make sure you go and check out Creed 2 once again in theaters. Steven, thank you so much, man.
Thank you, guys.
Pleasure. And we'll see you for Creed 3 when you do it. All right, guys. Once again, we'll see you tomorrow. And we're going to have a lot of fun. So, Collider Live.